I've been focused on the long game, drivers, mammoth performance things like strategy changes, business model shifts, distribution, the things I said. But these, as I said, require more time, more investment, more infrastructure, resource commitment, and a shift of your mindset. And many of you have not been able to get there yet. So today I'm going to go back to the future, and we're going to focus only on those 7 steps that are guaranteed to put multiple cash flow and monster-sized profit increases into your bank account, starting literally the day you get back, if you do anything with it. Effort is an asset that has a return. Time is an asset. Media is an asset. Salespeople are assets. One-time buyers are assets. Distribution channels are assets. Opportunity cost is an asset. Access to your market is an asset. Prospects, inactive buyers. Did you find that when you added more people, basically you had more credibility and you got more people buying quicker and longer? Yes or no? Would you say it's an asset? Is it an asset that dramatically increases your yield now and in the future? Yes? Good, thank you. Most people don't know that how you say or do things make a total difference, a measurable difference, 2, 3, 5 times different. Co-branding, you can find somebody with prestige and brand it just to get the front end, the first sale. Downselling, if you can't sell them what you want, you sell something else. If you create another product, low-end or high-end, it gives you 2 advantages. It gives you 2 advantages. Low-end lets you have an entry level that makes it easier to start. Lower-end can be added to each sale and double your profit, not your revenue. High-end lets you extend the lifetime value and thus multiply dramatically how much you can invest to bring the first sale in or compensate a salespeople. It's pretty profound.
We're going to have an extraordinary day today. Obviously, we're going to have Tony on stage for hours and hours and hours. And this morning, as we warm you up and prime you, we're going to have a man come on stage that does not do a lot of this anymore. It's not a small thing to say that he is an icon. If you know this man's name and know his work, there's 2 things that are absolutely true about him. Number one, he is a genius. Like, this is a genius. This is someone that Tony looks to and respects so deeply for the body of work he's created over 5 decades. I mean, Jay Abraham, dozens of books, literally success across so many different countries. I can remember as a kid when I was 25 years old, my parents, who were old because they were like 50, going to all of Jay's real estate seminars way back in the 80s and so forth. This is somebody who literally has left an imprint on the environment that we're in. So make no mistake, he's a genius. He sees things that nobody else sees. He communicates them in a way that literally nobody else on the planet can communicate. And if you're not familiar with his work, get ready, because it's going to be an extraordinary, extraordinary day. He has so many nuances and so many subtleties and so many distinctions that he can see things and extrapolate things and then communicate to them in manageable, usable ways. I promise you, if you pay attention today, it's going to be extraordinary. Who likes being in the space of greatness and genius? Who likes that? Say I. It's really very, very cool. And it's something he really just does here with our Platt family because of his relationship with Tony. And I will plant a seed with you, and that is he's looking to work with some of you. So as you're sitting here in these next 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 hours, however long they go for, just be thinking, dude, if I could have him in my team, if he could come and coach or mentor me, oh my gosh. So just think about that. Wherever you are in your business right now, I'll chat about it later on, but I do want to plant a seed. Jay always likes to come here and find 4 or 5 people that he wants to handpick to go, oh my gosh, you're doing this? Let's 10x that. You're doing that? Let's 20x that. So if you're thinking he might be a fit or he might be a challenge, sometimes that's the best coach you want, a challenge. Trust me, be thinking about that while he's teaching you today. This morning, he's going to teach you his Magnificent 7. Yeah, who's excited about your Magnificent 7? We'll do that for a little bit, get you primed, get you juiced, get you warmed up, and then we'll bring out the other icon in this room, the one and only Tony Robbins. And I want you to think about it. That means we got about I don't want to, you know, they've got about 95 years of experience and wisdom in two icons on the stage at once, and we're going to do hot seats, and I'll chat about the rules of the game, that, how you're going to do it, but literally we're just going to do Q&A. There's not a content, there's not syntax, it's Q&A from whatever you guys want, wherever you guys want at home. It's going to be absolutely the bomb. Second thing about Jay Abraham, and not a lot of people know this. He had, in the past, a reputation for like being a bit of a curmudgeon, bit of a grumpy old man, and it's just because he's brilliant. Like, he's literally one of the most brilliant people you could ever meet. And I gotta tell you, Tony asked me to share this, and it's my experience as well, and I've been to Jay's home, and we've been to the golf club, and we've connected. He is such a kind and generous and sweet man. It's unbelievable. I mean, he's so humble, considering what he's done and where he's at. He's incredibly generous with his time and his kindness and his words. And if you ever get the opportunity to spend some time with Jay Abraham, trust me, you want to do that. He's just a beautiful, beautiful, beautiful man. On top of that, I'm just going to say it. For a man his age, dude, this guy can dress. How many have seen Jay Abraham dress? Like, this guy has got it going on, for God's sake. So with that, here's a quick sneak peek, a little quick sizzle of the one and only Jay Abraham. Go.
Entrepreneurs, business owners struggle in their mind and heart a really weird question. Am I worthy of this goal? The question you should be asking yourself, is goal worthy of me?
Jay Abraham. Jay has spent his entire career solving complex problems and fixing underperforming businesses. As founder and CEO of the Abraham Group, Jay has significantly increased the bottom line of over 10,000 clients in more than 1,000 industries and over 7,200 sub-industries worldwide.
Through, you know, his teachings and what he's done for me, he's taught me how to position myself in very unique positions and then go after certain target markets.
Working with Jay has been a foundational and fundamental element of how we accelerated our business. I mean, we're twice the size we were when I started working with him. It's like you have somebody with deep intelligence to help you in so many facets of your business.
I love Jay. Jay's been a big source of inspiration for many, many years. And since COVID kicked in, it's been an incredible pivot opportunity and time to really shift my mindset and then going even deeper into a lot of his philosophies and wisdom and get those entwined so that it can be a monetary return.
Life is a series of mentors, and Jay Abraham is absolutely the best in that area.
If you think of most of the marketing consultants that you probably don't know the name of, they've all been influenced by Jay, including myself. I think he's the premier man when it comes to figuring out how do you take unrealized opportunities, how do you maximize, because this is all he's done for decade after decade after decade after decade, and he's always getting better.
Platinum family around the world, platinum family in this room, please be on your feet. An upstanding Tony's dear friend, an extraordinary icon in the world that he comes from. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, the one and only Jay Abraham!
And I'm going to do what I'll call a setup, not a setup in the negative, but just so you know the process and what we're going to do for the next couple of hours. A show of hands, how many of you have been a plat for at least 5 years? Okay, not a lot. How many have ever seen Tony and I in Amsterdam? Okay, cool. That was fun, wasn't it? This is the first live plat, and we're going to repeat the process we used before. You know, the bam, 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 instead of the slower process. I think it'll be fun. So how many have ever seen me present? Okay. Well, you know that at some of these events, I tend to be on perspective where I'm trying to do something very sophisticated. So I've got notes I'm going to refer to twice, and then I'm going to tell you what we're going to do and why. So bear with me, and I think you'll have fun. So right off the bat, I'm going to try to sell you something. And I'm going to try to sell not 10%, which most people do, but 100% of you. I'm going to try to sell it to you because I think it's something you all are going to want. I think it's something you will end up seeing by the time I'm done and Tony's done. You need. I think it's something that will dramatically increase your business health and wealth. Can I do that?
Yeah.
Okay, I need one person to come up here. I feel like a magician. Oh, by the way, I'm not, I always like to impress, but they said, I don't care, just one person, whoever can wrestle, I need you. I feel like a magician. We're going to do a quick magic act, and then we're going to get into my notes. But they said, you better dress really warm. So I've got three shirts on. I never wear socks normally. And the worst part, I got all these lovely, gorgeous jackets I only wear here, except COVID basically did that. So with three, okay, good. Okay, so, I don't have anything up my sleeves, do I?
No.
Okay, you see anything?
No. Nope.
Okay, all right. I want you to, tell people about how light this book is.
It's pretty heavy.
Now look at the back. How many pages is it?
447
pages. What do you think it weighs? 2 pounds? Pound? What do you think?
About a pound.
Okay, about a pound. And, okay, magician, nothing there. Now, you open it to the table of contents.
Sure.
Okay, and where's it at? You see these are a bunch of testimonials?
Yep.
Are they impressive?
I haven't read them yet.
Okay, well, you know the last name.
They're impressive.
Okay. Now, I'm going to get a different shill in the next time. Okay, so let's see where. Oh, wait a minute. Let me see if I can do this. Okay, hold on. What's very important? What's the title? This title.
Business Wealth.
Use this.
Business Wealth Without Risk.
What's the summit?
How to Create a Lifetime of Income and Wealth Every 3 to 5 Years.
Great. Okay, now this is the table of contents. Take a look at it. What do you think?
Very nice.
How nice? Okay, I think you might lose your job and it might send you back to basically the miners. Okay, stay here. Okay, you read it. What do you think about that? What do you think about table of contents?
This table of contents is freaking awesome. There's so much information here that...
He's good. Okay, read.
It's going to change your life.
Okay, who wrote the foreword?
Tony Robbins.
Wow. Wait a minute.
The one and only.
Who wrote the introduction?
Damon John.
Wow. Who wrote the preface?
Gino Wickman.
Okay. Now, what do you think this is about?
Business wealth, not a risk.
Yeah, and let me ask you as we go through it, does it have charts?
Yes.
And graphs?
Yes, sir.
And illustrations?
Yep.
And does it show target analysis? Yes. Jesus.
Can I have it?
Okay, now, so I'm going to sell you. Did anybody see me and Roland Frazier and I, me, whatever the right grammar is, when we did our session a couple of months ago for the Business Mastery 2? Did you like it? Okay, it was a preface for this book. This book is coming out next month. This book is like no other book. It is based on three premises. Number one, really cool, that why grow your business just organically or through strategy or marketing when concurrently you can acquire underperforming businesses that are competitive, complementary, things buy before, during, after, instead. You can get them with over 200 different strategies that don't cost out of pocket and the risk is minimized. You can blow them up with 97 of my methods and then you can exit for a massive payday. Does that sound cool? Okay, so I'm going to sell you not on buying it, although I probably could. I'm going to sell you on reading it. Okay, I am a mad scientist. Anyone who's ever seen me knows that. So I'm going to go through some notes. I'm going to go through a short 10-minute positioning. Then I'm going to go through a PowerPoint to the extent I can, but I got to tell you, and I'm going to screw up my notes. So I got mandated by Tony this time to do something dramatically different. Anybody that's ever seen me, when I got started, I basically was only marketing advertising and I was great at it. I tore it apart. I analyzed every driver, every leverage point. I would increase it and I made millions and millions, very truly myself, because I made people tens of millions more and a lot of them more than that. But I got bored with that because I realized that as important as marketing is, it is a diminishing resource. It doesn't last. It drives short-term front-end business, but it doesn't last because there's a lot of factors you can't control that can compromise it. You can saturate a market, algorithm can change, you can get competitors that either emulate you, plagiarize you, worse, innovate you, alternative means can come in and make your product, service, industry obsolete, the platform can lose popularity, then you can have a COVID event where you can't go anywhere, you can't show at a conference. So I realized long ago that if you play a long game, which is strategy, business model, massive strategy, preemptive business model, formidable value prop, and not just a unique selling proposition, but one that's almost a blue ocean moat. If you had massively expanded distribution channels, enormously expansive partnerships, joint ventures, endorsements, recommended provider status, co-branding and referral networks, and you knew how to reclaim sunk costs, things like leads that don't convert, buyers that stop buying, buyers that are buying but they're not buying everything they could, buyers that bought everything and you got nothing else to sell them, salespeople where there's variation into performance, brands you could do more with, distribution channels. Now your business explodes. And that's what I've tried for the last 8 years to really get people to do. And a lot of the plats have bought into it, but it requires a lot more resource, capital, commitment, infrastructure, and it's been a slow drudge, and I've been frustrated for, not by them, but for them. So what they asked me was to give you today something that was so concrete, so immediately actionable, so simple to comprehend, so rich with examples that it was infallible. And it was something that, unless you were brain dead, and I don't mean that disrespectfully, you could go home tomorrow and start doing it. So I got rid of the 97 concepts that I normally talk about, and we only isolated 7. And I'm ahead of myself because I'm a mad scientist. I'm going to now go through my notes, go through a preamble that I created, then I'm going to get into the PowerPoint. They also said don't do the 400 slides I usually do because I never get through them. So the good news is I did, also, if I make an offer to you, make it something that'll pay off so handsomely right away that you'll be, if you're qualified, you'll be massively inclined to take it. I'm not going to make an offer, but if we really nail it, and as I do this stuff with Tony, I can demonstrate application of the things I'm going to talk today, you're welcome, if you're qualified, to avail yourself. But I did everything they said except I got it down to 160 slides, but I'm not sure I can get through it. So I'm going to get ahead of myself, but I have a request, and I'm going to make sure we're in alignment before I start the PowerPoint. But I have a request that's different than normal. I have a PowerPoint I've never did. I've never done. I created it just for you guys and girls. It's taken me, no, seriously, I haven't slept much. I've been doing it for 3 weeks. It's back to the future. It's the foundational stuff I taught that created the IC Hots and the entrepreneur magazines and the billion-dollar investment firms that I used to do. And it's very foundational. It's designed to help you play a short and a mid-game so you can generate a ton of profits. And it's infallible. It's not what I usually concentrate on, so it's a fascinating ordeal because I had to come back to my basics and then update it for today, but it's cool. I'm going to deliver it. I'm going to ask you to stay in the moment and not take one iota of notes. Now, why would I do that? Anybody got an idea why? Yes, sir, in the back. So you can focus, because if I see you focusing and I don't see you taking notes, I will give you the entire PowerPoint at the end, and I've crafted it so it's self-explanatory. Now, please bear with me because I probably won't be able to deliver it in its entirety, but my PowerPoints tell a complete story. I got to get to the end because it's full circle. This is like one of those mystery crime where you don't know who did it till the end. Well, at the end is where we have you all not did it, do it. So it's very important, but I will give you the PowerPoint. I'll put it up. I'll ask, do not share it. But if I see a lot of you taking notes, I won't, because you won't be focused. And those of you who are watching, from my heart, when I do anything like a webinar, I refuse to let people make comments on the chat unless they have technical problems, because when they go, yay, right, preeminence, that means they're not paying attention. I don't need that. I know it's cool. By the way, I don't know what it was called, but my daughter used our methodology yesterday or all week, and they won the thing. And they said that they won because of the networking, the branding, the preeminence, the relational capital, all the things. Michelle, my daughter, used it, and they blew everybody away. So it's universally applicable if you do it. Okay, so let's see. We got you sold on the book, yes? Cool, all right. I told you the background. I did that, okay. I'm going to get to the end, even if I have to pass through it. Okay, that's it. Let's see, anything else? Okay, all right, so I got some notes I'm gonna share. It's on the back, so don't look, but I wrote everything. I was up, seriously, no bull. I was up 3 weeks working at this, and then I changed it all yesterday, and I was up until, so I'm gonna be working through stuff I've never done before. I doubt if I'll do anything like this, because my normal job is working on the long game, not the short and the mid. But I think if I help you all with the short and the mid, you'll have such unimaginable profit increases. You'll be able to go the distance and have the infrastructure, the time, and the focus. So bear with me, because I'm going to set this up, and it's very important, because I'm now going to do tough love, okay? And I need your cooperation, and all of you watching, you as well. Okay, so what I'm about to show you is going to, without a doubt, increase your profits, grow your revenues and success. I'm talking about the PowerPoint. Multiply your wealth. For those who get it, money won't be an object. Economic uncertainty won't be an issue. Competition will become close to as non-existent as you all want it to be. It's up to you. Okay, what that means is being in total control, watch me fall over, of your business. I blew my momentum. Your business future, your revenue growth, your profit performance, literally from this day on. Seriously. And don't try to understand everything right now, because if you, again, promise to stay in the moment, and I don't see people doing that, then I'll give you the PowerPoint. I want you to grasp the big idea. That's it. Which is simply that you have far more levers you can pull in virtually everything you do, everything, to produce monumentally greater profit outcomes. And as I said, if I see you engage, I'll give you the PowerPoint and I'll give you some comment. If you're a smaller business, I'll give you a simple, easy, result certain, go forward action game plan at the end. And if you're large enough and I blow your mind, we'll find a way to work together and I can help you realize everything if I can share in it, and it'll be very equitable. So it's a no-brainer. I've done these 7 steps you're about to learn in the PowerPoint for 80% of my career until I got into long game, and I made a fortune because I made other people bigger fortunes. But lately, as I already said, I've been focused on the long game drivers, mammoth performance things like strategy changes, business model shifts, distribution, the things I said. But these, as I said, require more time, more investment, more infrastructure, resource commitment, and a shift of your mindset. And many of you have not been able to get there yet. So today I'm going to go back to the future, and we're going to focus only on those 7 steps that are guaranteed to put multiple cash flow and monster-sized profit increases into your bank account, starting literally the day you get back, if you do anything with them. Everything we're focusing on today is low-hanging fruit. It's not complicated. When I give you the examples, when I give you the process, you go, geez, that's so obvious, Jay. Why didn't I think of it? Okay. In other words, these are specific actions and activities that, beyond everything else, produce immediate, multiplied, rapid results as long as you merely apply them. You got to apply them. Okay, the best part to me, at least, for you all, is they're amazingly forgiving. Meaning, even if you don't apply or execute them perfectly, guess what? They'll still work profit wonders for your business if you at least apply them. And in case you think any of these are difficult, let me ask you these, I hope, clarifying questions. Now, we're going to get into reality check. And I want you now, because you've been at Tony's so much this week, you probably haven't worked out a lot, have you? So I'm going to let you work out your hands. I'm going to ask you questions. And if they apply to you, no matter what I ask, raise one hand. And because you'll probably be raising, hopefully, a lot, raise the other, and you'll get exercise. You'll go home, and your significant others will say, where'd you get those muscles? And you'll say, Jay Abraham did it for me. Wow. They'll go, you look buff. To even add one more dimension to your ability to grasp the full magnitude of what I'm going to share in the time I have, Scott Harris has been invited to be interventionist. Every time I say anything that is confusing, because he's your advocate, or powerful but needs to be torqued down, he's going to come and bang me on the head, and he's going to interrupt me, and he's going to say, wait, Jay, I need explanation, because I'm here for you. But I need you to, this is now, we're going to be in tough love mode for about 10 minutes, okay? And this is for you, because I don't want to do this. I'm going to go back and going to share with you something I haven't done ever. I spent 3 weeks doing it for you. I spent all night fixing it for you. And I'm going to spend the better part of 2 hours sharing it with you in the most compression and rapid result manner I've ever done. And I don't know that I'll ever do it again, but I'm only going to do it if I sense you really want it. You're going to do something with it and we're connected. So narrate. Okay. First question to show you how hard this is. Are you guys and girls willing to safely try something one way, like a headline change or an email subject line replacement or a sales proposition alternative, and then try it another way, yes or no?
Yes.
Does that sound hard? Okay, good. Are you willing to safely test, say, one price point against another? Good. One combination of products and services together against no product? Combination? Are you guys too that are out there? Good. Okay. Are you or merely just adding a bonus to your sales offer against no bonus to potentially dramatically increase revenue and multiply profit potential through the roof? Yes? No? Cool. Okay. So the key to everything here is giving yourself quick, safe, easy wins. Unlike what I've wanted to do, which is build you this long-term, long game, meaning rapid result producing cash flow increases to your bottom line. I'm going to show you how to use the same business you run, the same marketing commitment you've been making or equivalent, the very same resources you have now, the same amount of time, effort, and investment you're making now, and double, and you'll see it. It'll see it. Double, redouble, even redouble again the results you start getting while realistically targeting not a 10x moonshot top line, but a 10x multiplying bottom line payoff. And it's much easier, just a point of reference. Everybody teaches, and I love it. Maybe Tony does even, 10X. Peter Diamandis, 10X. But they're talking about top line. And to get that, first of all, you've got to figure out what the technological drivers are, who the experts are, what the APIs are. Very expensive. They've never worked together in your business or industry. Then you've got to basically, it always is going to cost more and take longer that way than it does. It's like building your own custom house. Anybody ever built a custom house? Did it take less and cost less? Took longer, cost more. You almost got a divorce, or maybe you got a divorce, right? That's what happened to me. Okay, I'll never build a house again. But then when it's done, it usually doesn't work the way you want. You have to have two parallel universes, the old and the new. How are you going to fund it? Borrowing, diverting cash flow? Diluting equity. So instead of doing that first, you can get a 10x bottom line for no investment, no risk, just shifting performance and compounding it. Doesn't that make sense? Cool, isn't it? Okay, let's continue. Okay, perhaps that statement sounds audacious, even a little bold, but I'm going to prove it. I'm going to prove it that it's achievable. I'm going to prove it and fully demonstrate it in the rest of the PowerPoint. Am I saying to you, you're each going to make $1 billion and going to become a gajillionaire in your underwear overnight? No, that's stupid. Anybody who promises that is ludicrous. But I am saying unequivocally, everyone in this room who owns a business, irrespective of its size, can't talk, scope, and type, will monumentally multiply your success, income, and net worth, which is what Roland and I are fixated on. My job today is one thing, to give you strategies, action steps you can implement immediately to produce the stunning growth you're after. Okay, get ready. I'm also going to give you strategies you can thrive with in a downward market. Recessions won't be a problem if you understand this. Seriously, won't. I've always thrived with my clients. We've grown, believe it or not. Since I suspect you all want to win right away, we're going to be playing the short mid game only today. Next. Continue. Okay, but after I put a ton more profits in your bank account, I'll come back to you and teach you my longer, bigger game strategy that produced the icy hot endurance, the billion-dollar Agora Financial, and things like that. Okay, now we're going to get back to participation. And those larger companies in the room, I have the capacity to work with you short and mid if I blow your mind, if the opportunity and profit potential is good enough. If not, it's okay. So now I need you to self-identify. This is going to be this again. To confirm to me not only that you really want this, but see that, the why, and most importantly, the where and the how you need it the most. I need you to identify the applications you need, because a lot of people, when we say, do you have any questions? Do you have any problems? Do you have any challenges? Do you have any opportunities? And if you don't know what you're trying to solve or resolve or monetize, how are you going to do it? So, okay, get ready. Okay. All right, I'm going to show you with a show of hands right in the room. We're going to see if I've got the right message for the right people, and we're going to do something meaningful with it. Because if I do, I'm going to give you a great PowerPoint. If I don't, I'm going to go sit in the great room until Tony comes on. Serious. This is for you, but I don't want to give it if I'm entertainment. I stopped doing big seminars, and I was very large because I didn't want to be intellectual entertainment. I know my stuff works if you work it. I just want people to do with it. Okay. Ready. This is going to be participation. So I want you to answer honestly, all of you watching, all of you here. Are you stuck right now losing out business to the competition and don't know how to counter that? Raise your hand. Okay, look around the room. Are you stuck not selling enough? Raise your hand. Are you stuck with erratic business volume? 1 month it's great, new buyers. Next month it's down, you don't know how to mitigate it. Do you think you have mediocre marketing or selling approaches and you don't know how to improve them? Okay. How many of you want to achieve more scale or scope and do it faster, safer, more successfully? You all should raise your hand. How many want less scope? Let's do it. Go back for a minute. Go back to that for a minute. Okay. How many of you want less scale and scope and do it slower, more dangerously and expensive? Good. Okay. How many of you want to increase your market penetration, your brand posture? They told Michelle, my daughter, that one of the reasons they won is they had the clearest, most powerful brand positioning. How many of you want a superior competitive advantage that trumps and preempts everyone? Okay, I want you to see the game we're going to play. Or what more desirable products and services to sell, even if it means reconstituting your existing one, or need to find bigger, better opportunities to explode your business growth and profitability. Anybody want better opportunities? Only a few. Okay, you want less opportunity? I can give you those. I can change my PowerPoint. We can just talk about negative stuff. You want to do that? Let me tell you how to basically run your business into the ground. How many want to find better sources of higher value buyers and repeat buyers? Anybody? And by the way, if you only have a one-shot product, doesn't matter. I can show you how to turn it into a repeat buyer that'll buy for perpetuity if you understand the strategy. Or wish you had a bunch of high-profit joint ventures, strategic alliance partners, churning out no-risk, higher-margin, newfound buyers from all kinds of sources you can't reach right now. Duh. Only three of you? I'm going to prove to you, if I can get to it in the PowerPoint, everyone should do that, because the biggest corporations get something like 20% of their revenue and 40% of their volume from partners. Microsoft got something like, I don't know, $20 billion from their distribution partners. So if you don't think that works, I basically did $250 million of seminars when I was in that business, and my risk was $300,000, because I did Tony, I did Success Magazine, I did every financial newsletter, I had every seminar company promoting me, and I only paid them on the upside when it worked. You guys don't want a lot of that? You don't want to be the recommended provider. You don't want a network of consistent referral sources. Okay, well, raise your hand because I'm not, and you think I'm joking, I'm not. I am self-regulating. If I see a lot of buy-in and connection, I'm going to give you a lot more than you expect. If I don't, honest to God, I won't. Okay, we're going to solve the real problem as well as the true opportunity you need to better move. I can't read it. You stuck me here. No, the other way, the other way, the other way. Ah! Mine and monetize. You need to figure out what's the big focus. If you don't think you need any of these strategies I'm going to talk about, do me a favor. Respect everyone else. Go to the back of the room. Go sit outside. Have a coffee and come back when Tony's here. It's okay with me. Seriously. But if you need them, we'll work on it together. How many of you think you don't have enough time to get all you need done to grow your business? Raise your hand. Interesting. How many don't honestly know what your biggest bottlenecks, chokeholds, constraints are that are holding you back? Raise your hand. Okay, if you know what it is, then I'm hoping you're going to tell me when we do Tony that you're working on it. If you don't, then you really don't know it, because a lot of times what you think is the cause is really the symptom. And it's a totally different thing. How many of you think there's not much difference in how one marketing approach performs over another, or one strategy or competitive advantage over a different one? You think they're all the same? You do? Good. Okay. Anyone that raises your hand, go stand in the corner. How many of you understand that R&D doesn't just mean what Big Pharma does to discover new wonder drugs? It's what you do to discover new and better markets to penetrate, more competitive advantages, superior marketing approaches, more lucrative sources of better quality buyers. That's what R&D is. How many of you understand that if any of your assumptions are wrong, particularly about revenue, marketing, clients, value creation in your revenue generating approach, then guess what? Every assumption and action that follows from it is wrong. You ever think about that? How many of you think that lack of resources or capital is what's holding you back? Raise your hand. Okay, not many. I bet on a few. Okay, cool. How many think that growth has to be slow, costly, and incremental? That's good. One? Do you really? I'm not trying to castigate you. I'm just asking if you really believe that.
Please ignore me. Ignore my hand.
Okay, it went up. It's great.
No. Wait. I'm listening to everything that you are saying, and I want.
You're just excited. Okay, all right, cool. That's great.
Thank you.
Okay, how many of you think that a recession or down market has to be bad for your business? Raise your hand. You think it has to be bad? It's fun, isn't it? Cool. How do you know the lifetime value of your different categories of prospects and buyers, and that a prospect has a lifetime value? You guys know what it is? Not many. You need to. How many of you know that all prospects, all buyers, all types of buyers, all sources of buyers are not worth the same relative value to you and don't deserve the same relative amount of time, investment, or attention? Do you all know that? That's good. Okay, well, one. How many of you understand the blockbuster value of what is called allowable acquisition cost theory? Anybody understand that? You will if I have time, if I don't run out of time. It's the ability to give your business an unlimited marketing budget. Unlimited marketing budget. Seriously. Speaking of that, how many of you decide what and how much you'll spend on advertising, marketing, or even sales commissions out of thin air? You just arbitrarily decide, okay, I'm going to spend 5% of last month, or okay, I think we'll pay the salesperson 10%, or let's just arbitrarily spend 20 grand. We had a bad month. Only a few of you, or a lot of you? Okay, be honest. This is me trying to make sure I'm in the right room. How many of you have a business that is referral-based? Raise your hand. How many of you, with your hands up, keep them up, have at least three formalized, systematized, referral-generating strategies you are applying to keep growing those on a consistent, high-value basis. So it's good that a couple of you do. Congratulations. How many of you, how many of you really understand optimization, highest and best use theory, and religiously apply it to produce maximum profit results from minimum time, investment, or effort? It's very powerful. How many of you not only make irresistible offers your competitor doesn't or can't, and continually test different forms of risk reversal? Okay, well, risk reversal alone can give you a 50% increase if you do it right, and there's three different categories, five directions you can take, so you should be. How many of you even understand that if you don't make irresistible offers, this is hilariously realistic, it's a reality check. How many understand that if you don't make irresistible offers and unbeatable propositions, that means you're making resistible offers and beatable propositions? Think about it. I'm not playing games. That's what it means. How many of you or your ad people know the nine simple levers that can change in any ad you run anywhere to make it pull up to 21 times better? Do you know what they are? And 21 times is a rarity, but it's been measured. 3 to 5 times is not, and it can be quality enhancing, it can be conversion enhancing, and anybody can do it. How many of you have your own advisory board or mentors, and more importantly, what is called a masterful thinking partner to work through all your issues with you that comes at it from a more worldly point of view? Congratulations. Makes a difference, doesn't it? Big difference? Yeah, I bet it does. How many of you can clearly state what your one biggest problem or challenge or issue or underperforming opportunity is right now that's holding you back? How many can't? And this is just, this is heartfelt. How many can't? Okay. I mean, to be honest, because that's what I'm here for. How many of you understand the power of testing and the amazing profitability that lies in variability? Doing something one way, you can get X, do it something else, you get 10X. That's good. Hopefully Tony's done a great job of that. How many of you don't just understand but capitalize to the maximum profitability on the 80-20 rule by focusing greater time attention on those 20% that are the more valuable? Okay, not many. So how many are going to? Good. See, this is not really prelude. This is a little sort of a subtle way of teaching. How many of you have purchased at least one either competitive or complementary business or strategically beneficial one in the last couple of years to blow up your EBITDA? Did it help? A lot? Who else did it? Eric, is this fun? Am I doing okay? Thank you. How many of you know what your buyers purchase before, during, after, and even instead of what they buy from you? Anybody? One of the most preemptive things you do is go into the business of what they buy before, then you have access to them before anybody else. And if it's a product that's not terribly expensive, but it is a prelude, you can underprice it like mad or overvalue it with lots and lots and lots of bonuses or benefits. I could go on for hours. I really can, and now I'm into basically short and mid-game strategy. In fact, are these questions provocative? Yes. Eric, tell me about my 200-question questionnaire. Is it a mind blow? Did you answer it all? I have a 200-question assessment that we give everybody who's a client. Nobody can answer it. If you would like, I'll give everybody the questionnaire, even though, and it's almost an education, isn't it? Who else got it? You guys got it. It's pretty cool, isn't it? Ask questions that most people have never thought about. Okay. All right. So show of hands, please. I'm imagining you want to learn all the right strategies today so you can thrive in a down market and just kill it and up. Is that right? Or you want to kill it? You want to get killed in a down market? Okay. Okay. So we all agree that you recognize that your business has problems and opportunities and it needs to solve, i.e. jobs to be done, then I'm going to address them right now with the rest of the time I've got with the PowerPoint. But I want you to tell you how I see your business. I see you as a Ferrari that's been unknowingly powered by a four-cylinder, 100 horsepower, very, very weak engine driving your growth and profitability. And I want to replace it today, not just with the session I do, because I won't get it all done, but I'll give you the PowerPoint, but with the things Tony and I do and my ability to have little out-of-body demonstrations. And this is something I either covered or didn't. And I want you to end up with a 16-cylinder, 975-horsepower, supercharged AMG-type engine driving the damn business. Same time, so we're almost done with the prelude. Is this prelude cool? Is it getting you thinking? Can you imagine what the PowerPoint that I probably won't get through is going to be? Pretty damn impressive. And it's seven ways, seven steps that blow your mind that anybody can do the moment you get home. So I think you've been wearing out that underperforming engine, trying to compete, or even those more successful ones, lap and lead the competition. Or should I say that many of your strategies and approaches you're applying now probably aren't capable, no shame, in delivering the scope and speed of profit increases that you're really after. They just can't. They won't. But all you need to do, this is the coolest thing I realized 40 years ago, is replace the worn-out, overtaxed, underperforming approaches with just a few, not all, a few of the higher-performing super strategies that I will teach and Tony teaches, and everything, honestly, will change, as Tony says, in a heartbeat. Now, parenthetically, this is the fun thing. You know how Tony makes you walk over coals? I never did it, I wanted to build a 100-foot whatever you call the tub of Jell-O, so we could have you walk through it with the metaphor, it's not that hard. I never did it, but I always thought that would be fun. You can laugh. I'm going to give you the method. I'm going to give you the right strategy so that every day from now on, whether you're in a down or an up market, you're killing it if you take action. You'll quickly know the few things to move the needle the most, the easiest, the least amount of effort and risk or investment. And remember, as we go through the PowerPoint, if you're going to keep doing what you've been doing, honest to God, you can't possibly expect any meaningful different result. Anybody know Einstein's explanation of insanity? What is it? Doing the same thing over and over again, you're going to get no different result. That's insanity. So, okay, and by the way, those of you doing very, very well, if you think this doesn't apply to me, respectfully, think again, because I have found most successful companies are actually successfully stuck. You're outperforming, you're compounding at 20, 30, 40%, you're just mitting money, but guess what? What if you're accepting a fraction of the fraction of the true performance, the effort, the opportunity, the assets in play, the salespeople, the brand, distribution channel, the buyers, the prospects, the relationships could be delivering? So I'm going to give you today a lot, and then I'm going to help you do what Tony, you know, is five to thrive. You just pick five easy ones that you can win with. So I've applied all the strategies we're going to cover. They've all worked massively. Remember, I have 97. I've picked out just the seven best of them all, the easiest, the most infallible. If you take action, I'm here to help you have more success starting tomorrow, but that won't happen unless you see that I have something important, something vital, something mission critical, or multiple things you need. Do you see that? Yes. Seriously, I'm not for my ego. I know it. Okay, so have I accomplished my prelude? It's a long prelude, but did I set the stage well? Yes. Cool. Okay. All right. Now, a lot of you probably are so excited that you want to just stop now, get out of here early, get an earlier flight home and start doing it. And a bunch of you bigger companies probably want to run up right here and say, can I give you money, Jay? I need you. But don't do it, okay? Because what we're going to do with Tony and I afterwards will blow your mind and will demonstrate applications that when you go home, it'll seed much better your understanding. Okay, you ready for the PowerPoint? Let's do it. And you're going to get it if I don't see you take notes. If I see you take notes, you won't. And I'll just, you won't get it all. And who will be the loser? Me or you? Okay. Okay, now we're ready for the PowerPoint. Let's do it. Got the PowerPoint? No, I don't need that. I don't need that anymore, the PowerPoint. Oh, over there. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So this is a quote that it's mine. Let me go back, see if I did it right. Is that back? Okay. Your goal in business, I think, as always, should be to gain absolute ethical advantage in everything you do by making a bigger difference for your market, by adding more value, by caring more about people, and by really doing it differently than everybody else. It's just a similar, okay. All right, so who here feels like in the pressure of the increase? We already did that. I don't need to do that since I did it. Okay, do you feel like it's hard to make the right decision? Do I decide to do this or that or spend this or that or nothing? Hire, fire, stay, try this. Anybody feel that way? Raise your hand. Yeah, I know. So what we're going to share is going to be showing you how to create wealth with your business, proven strategies, recession proofing, and we already covered. See, I always duplicate myself, so I'm going to skip through. I'm going to teach you how to create all of this in 7 magnificent steps. Creating more business wealth without risk. 7 magnificent steps. This is how you recession proof any business. This is how you basically blow past the competition. This is how you sleep like a baby at night. This is how you have predictability and certainty. Okay, it's how to multiply your sales. I already said for no day. It says, I'm just skipping through things that I've already covered in the prelude. But everything you do in and on your business should have a duality. It should be cash flow enhancing, profit boosting, but should also constantly being, it should build the asset value, your net worth. And the same effort should and can. So if you're not doing it, you need to rethink. So everything I do is based on taking the same time, same effort, same resource, same opportunity, and doing more with it. This, and he may be here, I don't know if he joined. We have a client, very lovely client in one of our masterminds, and he's got the most successful classic guitar resell platform in the world. And they're very expensive. Anybody collect guitars? They're like 15, 20, 30 grand. I got 2 of them for my son. One's 20 grand, one's 18. They're beautiful, and they're very valuable, and they're going up. But he sells 300-400 a year. But he's got 400,000 people who play guitar, who are aspiring guitar players, who can't afford 15 or 20, but someday could, that he does nothing with. That's why the guitar is here, as a metaphor to me to show you how illogical it is not to benevolently but monetize and help those people progress through the process. Okay, how do you guarantee your bottom line keeps growing while your net worth increases? Okay, you basically only work on the geometry of your business. You always operate in what I call the exponential zone, not the incremental zone. I have a beautiful example. I'm not going to do it because it takes too long, but it's cooler than hell. Cooler than hell. Maybe someday, maybe I'll do it when Tony are on. Okay, you discover and then probably apply the 10-10-10 equivalent. Tony's taught it, right? Raise your hand. Who knows the 10-10-10? Keep it up for a minute. Everybody keep it up. Who is actually doing much with the 10-10-10? Keep it up if you are. Okay, the ones that have your hand up, has it worked? Has it worked significantly? Has it worked safely? Is it pretty profound? Well, guess what? I'm going to give you 7 more 10-10-10s to add. Okay, if you do anything with it. Cool. So everything about this, small changes, I would say incremental, small, slow changes, exponential, huge positive increases, rapid increases in size and scope of results. We already talked about it. You're all working your ass off and not getting the kind of things you want. You need what's going to move the needle. Okay. And it's mission critical because here's the challenge. I don't care what you make. Let's say you're a lifestyle entrepreneur and you're making, I don't care, 500,000, a million. It's, if you take an analogy, imagine you had all your assets in a portfolio that was being managed, and every year they're giving you 500 grand, but then when you retire, they're giving you nothing because it hasn't grown. It hasn't really compounded. That's what a lifestyle entrepreneur that doesn't figure out the asset value, and that's what an entrepreneur that accepts a fraction multiple of what it could be. This book that you promised you're going to read, right? You're going to read it. I sold you on everyone. Did I get 100% sale so I can walk off and tell Tony? I sold 100% of the audience. Pretty cool, right? I need an award. Okay, let's do a reality check. When I first saw the slide they put in here, I thought it was a girl diving into the abyss, but it's really, I guess, What is it? She's goggles. Is that whatever they call them? Oculus goggles or something? All right, so it's a new way of seeing things. It's easier, faster, safer. I already made that case. I wasn't going to do it originally, but that's on how a 10X bottom line is so much easier, safer, and doable than a 10X top line. Do you all see that? Okay, it makes sense, doesn't it? Then you use that freed up newfound cash to fund the harder, more dangerous, risky, speculative, costly, and uncertain top line that you're going for. Okay, your whole goal is to maximize performance of everything you do. These are how you do it. First of all, you learn to maximize everything you do and not minimize or suboptimize. Then you gain the highest, best use. Tony does a good job of doing it. Years ago, we talked about this. I think he ran with it in a very wonderful way, his OptiMax. But that's what it is. So you always, in my opinion, want to work on my, Sony has his five to thrive. These are mine. You want to constantly increase predictable current income. You want to constantly increase predictable future income. You want to constantly increase what I call your windfall, newfound income from all kinds of jackpot areas. You want to have increased fulfillment, emotional, psychic. If you're not having any fun, you shouldn't be doing it. It's miserable, isn't it? You can't do your best. And guess what number five is? Anyone want to yell it out? Net worth. Anybody want to increase their net worth so they don't have to keep doing this? You love it. Would you rather love it because you don't need it, or you want to love it because you need it? You want to love it because if you sell it, you're going to get a year or two of income and then you got to figure what to do, or you want to sell it and get a lifetime of income? Duh. Okay, I'm trying to give you a reality check. Is it working? Am I fun? Aren't you? This is better than that. This is better than working. Should I tell Tony not to come on? Yes, sir. It means getting fulfillment from what you're doing. It rocks your boat. It animates your spirit. It makes your heart sing. Does that make sense? As opposed to hating getting up on a Monday morning. You love getting up on a Monday morning. Work is not work. It's joy. You love not just the business you're in, not just the product or service or the industry. You love the people you impact. And there's three kinds of clients. We may or may not get into it. The people who pay you and the people you pay. You should be committed to wanting to grow and develop the collaborative benefit and contribution value and capability of your team for their benefit. And when you have the right attitude, it makes everything much more joyous. Can't you tell I'm having a good time? I always have a good time because I have the right attitude and I understand where leverage lies and where risk lies and how to really blow past the latter and focus on the former. Okay. So your goal is always work, is get your business always working harder for you. It's axiomatic. Then you work for your business. So what it means is you install something once and you're able to mine constant, never-ending compound profits. Maybe not forever, but for a sustaining period. That's how you have predictability. Predictable revenue, predictable flow of clients, predictable referrals, predictable asset growth. So again, I'm going to show everyone in the room the seven easiest steps. And I'm going to give you lots of examples, time allowing. And if not, I'll give you plenty of examples parenthetically when Tony and I do the collaborative hot seats. Okay, I already told you I'm going to do that. So basically the same things that I use to grow long-term, but I started using them in the beginning with Icy Hot, Entrepreneur, all these clients of mine. You don't need to see this. Okay, so most entrepreneurs think really erroneously that goals like I'm talking about are impossible, but in truth, and I think Tony's done a good job of pummeling this in probably, in truth, they're only impossible unless you don't shift the game you're playing. Meaning that you don't just apply one category or no categories of the 10-10-10. You harness all seven keys and you blow past that and you use leverage on leverage on leverage, and it's like exponentiality on steroids. Anybody a mathematician? Do you understand that there are, I think, five or seven gradients beyond exponentiation? I think they're called hyper-operationalizing. And if you look at it, it's like tetration, heptation, pentation, octation. I can't remember what the other tation is. But if you look at it, I mean, you wouldn't even calculate. It's off the chart. And if there is proof you can perform well, well above exponential, do you think setting a goal of exponential growth is really that hard? It's just shifting what you do and how you do it. Okay, so I told you I've got 97. We're only going to do the best seven. I want you to think like a hedge fund manager about everything you do. And I want you to run your business like it by focusing squarely on how to achieve maximum outside upsize and minimum downside risk. A hedge fund, maybe there's one here. Theoretically, you're looking to allocate assets that will perform above market with less risk, unless you're a very risk-oriented one, and I don't recommend it. And if it doesn't, you shift your asset pool, don't you? But, see if I did this. You know, what it means, you start generating returns on your investments that dramatically beat all the competitors you're competing against. I'm going to really upset you in a minute. So if your business is a hedge fund, you have to allocate, reallocate the assets you're allocating risk, time, opportunity cost, capital, human capital on, because most people don't have any clue what kind of risk they're taking on something, a person, an area, an activity, and what kind of a yield they're getting now and in the future. If you don't know, how can you possibly maximize? If you had your money with somebody that didn't have a clue what risk they were taking with it, what yield they were getting, would you let them keep your money? And if they had all your capital allocated and 60% was in something that had a 40 or 50% risk and a 3% yield, and only 10 was in something that had maybe a 50% yield and a 3% risk, and they didn't shift, would you keep your money there? But I really want to not shock you, but that's what you do with your business. Does that make sense? Think about it. It immediately connects, doesn't it? I'm very blessed. I can take very complex things, and in the past, I've tried to teach complex things, which I think is wrong. I'm going to try to bring it down to lowest common connective denominator, where you go, oh, my God, I see that. Ah! And then you go from ah to yay, because you see now you can shift in a heartbeat, right? Okay. Big difference between spending for unpredictable, unknown returns and investing for highly predictable, measurable returns. Most people don't understand that in their business. So think clearly about the profound difference. Spending is speculating, oftentimes wasting money for low, no yield. Investing utilizes your capital to build your profit-enhancing business portfolio. Okay, I still think she looks like she's off a diving board going into the deep. Reality check number two. I have a very nice person that helps me do it, and I didn't want to hurt his feelings, but I think I'll probably change that slide. Okay, get ready for this. You ready? This is so cool. I've never done this before. I did this just for you. Okay, take a deep breath. Okay, guess what? Effort is an asset that has a return. Time is an asset. Media is an asset. Salespeople are assets. One-time buyers are assets. Distribution channels are assets. Opportunity cost is an asset. Access to your market is an asset. Prospects, inactive buyers, they're assets. Your value proposition is an asset. Your website, social media, they're all assets. Testimonials, endorsements, reviews are assets. Who's got a lot? Did you find that when you added more people, basically you had more credibility and you got more people buying quicker and longer? Yes or no? Would you say it's an asset? Is it an asset that dramatically increases your yield now and in the future? Yes? Good, thank you. Okay, even satisfied buyers you failed to secure killer testimonials and referrals from. Guess what they are? Assets. Come on, what are they?
Assets.
All right, geez. Okay, remember, if you stop and if I see you taking notes, I stop and go back and then I basically wait for Tony. So stay connected, promise? The payoff to you will be unimaginable. Okay, this is just to show you. You don't have to look at any of this except for the, I think it's 40. I have a very dear friend. He's a specialist in SEO optimization. These are the 40 tools and apps that he uses to blow people's organic search and conversion off the chart. I actually have a relative that is a PI attorney. He had no placement at all, and he went to him, and the guy used this thing. I'm not selling him. I'm just showing you the leverage nobody tells you about. One area, 40 different things. You don't have to do 40 different things, but if you do no different things, do you think maybe if you did three or four? And my guy went, by the way, my cousin went from number no to the top in every meaningful category, and they have more cases than they can handle, and their biggest problem now, which is good, they can't hire enough attorneys and legal assistants. But look at this, one category, 40 different levers nobody probably tells you about. I'm not, by the way, digital marketing, I'm not SEO, I just found that mind-blowingly impressive. You know, take a picture, okay, if you take a picture, I'm not gonna do it. Stay in the moment, serious, honest to God. I know this. I can leave. I want you in the moment. I'm going to give you this. I'm going to give it all to you if you give back to me. If you don't, I won't. Fair enough? And I mean, this is like tough love. If you don't stay in the moment, here's something very important. Research demonstrates unequivocally, when you are exposed to anything new, seminar, book, consultant, crazy, mad scientist, Jay, at most you retain 9% of what you hear. 9%. That's why I give things to people. Oh, by the way, at the book, and we don't try to get your name. You can freely download it. There's no, we're not trying to capture your name at all. It's a gift to you guys. We also repeated. We put there the recording of Roland and I from that two-hour thing we did, because I don't think anybody can remember it all. Hey. When I do my seminars, I give everybody the recordings, I give them transcripts, because I want to make sure what I'm about to say. So if you get diverted, you get 9% you retain if you're paying attention. If you, the woman who's taking pictures, is paying attention. If you divert, you may only get half. You may only get 4.5%. So that's why I encourage people to rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat, rinse and repeat, so that you will retain more and you'll have an advantage over most people. But that's why I want you in the moment. I don't mind giving you everything. I know it, I just don't share it. This is very powerful stuff that's made billions of dollars, 50 or 100 billion dollars and counting, but I want you to stay in the moment. So your investment in all these assets is your hedge fund called your business without knowing the return risk. I already said that. How can you possibly get the maximum result out of your life investment, out of your emotional investment, out of what's supposed to fulfill and enrich you every day, pay your lifestyle, pay your retirement, give you this massive exit? So there's the investment you make in the business and the investment within the business. Very different. Very different. So for example, you might pay $200 to acquire a client, but if you don't know the yield, it might be yielding you $1,000 return, which is so much off the chart. And by the way, I think I'm going to be redundant. How many people here have a business? I've got echo here. Have a business where you invest in capital equipment? Raise your hand. Okay, those of you doing it, what kind of return do you want to get? I mean, how long is the payback usually? How many years? How many years? Just yell it out. 5 years? 3 years? Okay. So you get basically, whether it's 33 or 20% payback annually, right? You could invest in all the things we're talking about and get a payback, guess what? 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months. So what's wrong with this picture? Nobody's ever thought this way. Am I changing the way you're seeing your business? So that's what, I mean, I've been blessed, just so you know it. I have had 300 experts I've helped and all their expertise rubbed off. I've had 20 of the world's greatest mentors. So don't go, oh, he's so bright. I've been pummeled by people who've reduced it down to these kind of understandings. And that's why I've been able to propel people. And the clients I've had in the past year, I've tried to take you down a more sophisticated route. And I realize that this is probably easier for you, because if I blow your bank account up, not just your mind, then you can afford to play a longer game. So what it means is you get far more profits from improving your internal performance, how your salespeople sell. How many people have a sales force that's significant? How many people that have a sales force that's significant have variability in who performs? Some are better, some are worse. How many know where they perform best in the more micro? Who's better at opening accounts? Who's better at And how many know how to get every salesperson, an immediate 10% increase? How many would like to know that? Okay, I will tell you later on when we have somebody that's here, only because I want to go through it. It's not. You get more profits from improving your internal performance. I already said that. Okay, So here's a really, am I too vulgar for you? Am I going to be woke done? I love it. Oh gosh, Cello, I'm going to take you home. Every time I talk to my wife, I want you to do that, okay? Take out the garbage. Play something. Okay. I love it. So, okay, this is profound. You ready for profound, a catalytic moment? Okay, earth-shattering, shifting. So most entrepreneurs are 2D investors. And they see revenue minus expense equals profit. It's very static. The ones I'm trying to impact, i.e. all of you here and all of you, I'm pointing to a screen with all of you virtual. I see you, but I'm looking out, so hopefully you see me. Wave, all you virtuals, wave. Trainer Mark, Team Tony, you're not waving. Come on. If you guys don't do it, it's going to be terrible if Team Tony pulls you down because they don't cooperate and they're taking notes, wouldn't it? Then you'll have to castigate them. You'll have to basically, there was this crazy guy. Anybody old as I am and remember Steve Allen? Anybody? So this guy, Steve Allen, had like a Tonight Show, and he used to sing a song, "We Stoned the Philistines." It makes no relevance here. I just thought about it. Okay, so a 3D investor thinks not short-term static. They think, what's the ongoing yield I'm going to get on that asset? And how can I enhance the upside? How can I get an asymmetric up and minimize the down? It's a whole different game. When you play that game and your competitor doesn't, guess what? You have massive ethical advantage. Does that make sense before I move on? And Scott Harris, you can interrupt any time for any reason, and I will respect it. Okay, I already talked about the 20% for 3 to 5 years versus 2 to 3 days, weeks, or months. Pretty profound. Okay, all you need is one or two, and Tony has his five to thrive. First one, you ready? I gave birth to this years ago. Very few people do it. If you go online and look up the strategy of preeminence, I think there's, 10 pages, 80% is mine. It's quite profound. I'll give you the short. It takes about 4 hours, but I'll give you the short version. So it's about preeminence really means being the best at what you do relative to the outcome, benefit, advantage, protection your product, service, company provides, and having the market see you as the best, not just the best in terms of, oh, they're so cool, but the best choice to make, the best to provide the outcome, the best to choose and retain, the best to basically connect with and buy from. So I'm going to give you a bunch of things. So it's a strategic philosophy that I created. It drives and fuels everything in your business, and it elevates you a stature, a posture, a preemptive position way above the maddening competitive crowd. It's the who, the what, the why you stand for. If you don't know what you stand for, who you stand for, why you stand for, what standing for it means, how standing for it manifests, just by doing that, it changes everything. It's the force that gives you advantage. It's the persona you give and imbue in your products. It's the animation, the spirit, the crusade and mission your people are on. It's being seen as the most trusted advisor by everybody you talk to, the go-to source. Okay, it pervades your marketing, your advertising, your salespeople, your messaging. And it becomes really your reason, what is it, raison d'etre, the reason you exist. And it's very animating. When you're playing at that level, it's like the world is a 3D movie and you have the only pair of glasses. It's just liberating, intoxicating, wonderful. It's just so different. So here's an example, just so you see references, because Tony said, you better give him references. I can't use his voice. Oh, I don't do it as well. Better give him references. So Netflix, Apple, Amazon, Ritz-Carlton, JetBlue, Disney, HubSpot, IBM, FedEx, IKEA, they're all different in the food chain. But think about them versus their competitors, the preeminent leaders, because they imbue this. Kate, they are the absolute best above the maddening crown in the eyes of the market. It doesn't matter if you're B2C, B2D, high end, low end, sell to the masses, sell to the classes. It doesn't matter. Okay, here's some of the dynamics. Do not write it down. Do not take pictures. You're taking pictures. Stand in the corner. Give me the dunce hat. They're not. She's trying to compromise. She doesn't want any of you guys to get the... Do you not trust me to give you the... You think I won't give you the PowerPoint? You don't trust me. I trust you. But you're breaching it. I bet you text when you're driving, don't you? Promise you're going to watch? Okay. Great metaphor. Okay, here's the highlights of being preeminent, and almost every preeminent company, and you, if you want to do it, will either have some of them or combinations. They build a vibrant, loyal community. They connect continually, deeply, meaningfully with their audience, and it's authentic. It's not manipulated, superficial, or stilted. They develop a unique and valued sales proposition and brand persona that speaks to the felt need of the market in ways the market thinks I've never thought about it that way before. Have I given you already today a way of thinking about I've never thought about it that way before? That's because guess what? I am preeminent. And you can be too. Maybe you aren't going to be my preeminent because you have a different business, market, audience, price point, but you can be preeminent up and down the food chain. They are consistent in their quality and service, and they understand that quality, service, value is a subjective construct. What you think is quality may not be what your audience thinks is quality. So you have to basically, you have to give them what they want, not what you want them necessarily to have initially. There's a bigger discussion on that. They are consistent in quality service, and they have an almost impenetrable bond with their advocate client fans. The clients are their fans, their advocates. They sell for them. They sing their praises. They go, ah, it's so cool. The client to them is king. They know that the client experience genuinely matters to their buyers. I have a client, the number one Honda Acura dealer, I think, in the world, certainly in North America, and he's got the most frictionless belief system. When you he picks up 3,000 cars a month on service, but he's got an app that tells you exactly the process, so you don't have to call and be put on hold and feel like a, geez, what, nobody knows who you are, and they've got to find your paperwork, and you have to think, what's it like to be in their shoes? What's it like to be on the receiving end? They know that the client, okay, I said that. Great preeminent businesses see services not as additional costs, but rather as sales opportunities to bond, to contribute, to enhance, to outvalue the competition. Okay, here's some examples. Uber, who's identified all the pain points and eliminated them. Netflix with their customer-client personalization. Ritz-Carlton will go to almost any lengths for their clients. JetBlue, empathy, authentic interest. I fly Mint all the time because it's a giggle. I really like it. And it's more fun to me than United or American Disney because they're fanatical about the oriented towards the customer and the client attention and personal experiences. Amazon, huge client-centric, which cannot be possible without a genuine focus on the interest, and they've also got a lot of AI. IKEA, where the business leaders and managers rack their brains to eliminate all points of friction and tension, and each brand exudes from every pore of their philosophical being a distinctive personality of competency, excitement, excellent durability, depending on what they stand for. One brand that embodies sincerity is Bombas Socks. You know what that is? They give a pair every time you buy. One that embodies sophistication, Rolex. One that embodies excitement, Red Bull. They're centered in advertising around extreme sports and high-energy life. They look at here's a look at the key drivers so I can bring it down to something you understand and can translate. They show true empathy for their audience, their market, their client. They're selling leadership always, not information. They're telling you what they believe is in your best interest and why. They convey that they feel what you feel. Did I convey that I feel what you feel today? I have empathic connection with you. Hopefully, I connected enough that maybe I'll help some of you privately, but whether I do or not, I connected with you because I was able to express what you were trying to get closer to or away from, pain, pleasure. You have to do the same relatively for your audience if you want to lead and lap your competition. They give advice instead of information. They help people achieve focus. Focus basically gives people power. When they have power, they can make decisions easier. When they're unfocused and they're undecisive, they can't. They put into words what people want. We call it mind of the market. I'm going to waste 3 minutes of my very limited PowerPoint. I only have 48 minutes left and a lot more to cover because we're on step one by giving you how to have the mind of the market. You ready? Whatever you sell, this is a very powerful concept. It's infallible. I've shared it before, but I'll do it again. Whatever you sell, whoever you sell to, if you want to know how to speak to your audience in a way that penetrates the subconscious, all the resistance, the deflectors, and get right to the heart of penetrates to the subconscious and get right to the heart of their being, all you have to do is the following. Go online, go to Amazon, look up books that are for the last 3 or 4 years that have been successful in whatever the category you are in or all the related. If you're in weight loss also has self-esteem, love, health, sexuality, all those things. Look at the titles. I'm going to do this fast. The subtitles and the chapter titles. Why? Because most books sell because of the promise and the premise. Not always by the content. Our book that we're gifting you is mind-blowingly incredible, but most books sell by the promise. Strip that out, put it somewhere, because that will give you enormous, enormous insight. Then, this is the real key, go to the reviews of all these books. In Amazon, I think they're 0 to 5. Is that correct? So think about this, and think about your own life. When people are passionate, positively passionate, I love it. Negatively passionate, what an effing waste. I gave my valuable time for that piece of, you know what? Their subconscious overrides their conscious. And out of their brain comes this most amazing articulation that's very sinewy, very crisp, very on point of what they wanted, what they didn't want, what they got, what they didn't want. All you have to do is strip the fives, which are the positives, the negative, put them in a file. Next, now you go to discussion groups about the subjects and you do the same. Next, you go to review sites of your competitors and you. Now, you know exactly how to speak to your market about what they want, what they don't want. You know that. Here's what we do. And you put it in the language patterns that go right to their subconscious. Is that cool or what? You turn it into your ads. You turn it into your landing page. You turn it into your sales scripts. You turn it into your collateral material, you turn it into your emails. I've done it for every client. It kills. So I just gave you a massive boost. You owe me big time, okay? Big time. The way you can repay me instead of giving me a big profit share is all of you who still are fertile, when you have your next born, name them for me. And if they're twins, it can be J1 and 2. Doesn't matter the gender, okay? All right. Promise? No pictures, no notes. I'm looking. I don't want one of you to contaminate the opportunity for everybody and yourself. So let's look at the key drivers. They make you, the client, customer, the focus of attention. They call it the you attitude. It's not about me. I'm speaking when I talk right now to one person at a time. There's 400 of you all total, but you're hearing it one person at a time. When you write ads, when you do radio, television, YouTube, you're speaking to one human being at a time, one delicate, basically, usually scared little child who's trying to fake it through life, human being at a time. And if you understand that and they feel understood, appreciated, and that you have their best interest, not yours at heart, you have a great advantage over the people that don't. They have a genuine hopefulness for their client. Do you not see that I have a hopefulness? Maybe if I'm lucky, 5 or 10 of you will want to do something. Most of you are too small. My hopefulness is I want to see you go back and do something massive, monstrous. It'd be just unimaginable with this understanding. Because if you have a business that genuinely adds more value, protects, enhances, enriches, entertains better than your competitors, it is a travesty not to let you have more access to them than people that deserve them. If you enrich them and you accept a fraction of the people you should be helping or serving, you're cheating them. Not even you, you're cheating them. Do you understand that? That's being preeminent. They have an obligation to not let people avoid taking action like I'm doing to you. And if you take a picture next, I'll grab the camera and I'll throw it on the wall. I don't think I can throw it that far, but I'll try. Then I'll hit somebody over the head and I'll get sued. But that's okay. Am I fun? Am I the way Tony said I would be? What did he say? Did he say Jay's crazy? I am fun. I think you can accomplish a lot and have a great time doing it. And that's what preeminence is all about, is operating at such a rarefied strata of understanding that it's a joyous game. You're not making fun, but it's a game. You're just having the time of your life. And you're going, that person's miserable. I'm not. That person doesn't have a clue what to do. I do. That person's not going to be successful. I am. And I'm going to kill it. Okay. They know the difference of client versus customer. This is very important. If you really want to be the most trusted advisor in life, I call everybody client. Today I'm using a back and forth because I'm not sure Tony does client. If you look up the Webster's Dictionary of the word customer, you know what it means? Somebody who, you don't have to say yes, I'll tell you. Somebody who buys a commodity or a service. So if I call you a customer, you want to know what I'm really saying? Between the lines, what I'm saying, it's a little scary. I'm no more valuable than anybody else. I'm just a commoditized, generic, and I'm lucky as hell I get business because I have nothing unique to offer. A client, if you look it up, is somebody under the care, the protection, the well-being of another. It's got a fiduciary connotation, and if you really live it, your team sees their relationship at a much different level. They have a continuous positive effect each time they connect. Am I having a positive effect on you? Am I uplifting you? Am I giving you optimism, clarity? Do you think you could do the same for your market, for your team, not just for the people who pay you, but the people you pay? Because frankly, one of the greatest underutilized assets you have is human capital. And if people don't perform the way you want, you think they're lazy. What have you done to help them? How have you tried to grow their understanding of productivity, of connectivity, of listening, of collaboration? How have you helped them? When I ask people, you train your salespeople, most people say, of course. Then I say, no, not do you teach them that this is basically got 17 transistors and it's designed to shoot a wave 47. No, do you train them in consultative selling and listening and trust building? Stephen M. R. Covey, the world authority on trust building, is about 40 soft skills like that, has shown that if you command your people or your company the 13 characteristics of, he's got a better word for it, but it's like unbreakable trust, it gives you a 300% increase in the speed of sale, the repeat, the stock value. A man named Roger Love has seen a 300% impact by teaching you what he calls strategic communication. You'll see that I communicate in a very, very specific way, with tonality, with inflection, when I'm not trying to make you laugh, pauses. Not manipulative. It has a much more powerful authority, believability, leadership. There's another woman. I can go on and on. There's all these soft skills. If you don't really add them and help your team, you're the one that they're the asset in your portfolio. They fall in love with their clients more so than their own business. And they see, this is very important, they see their product or service not static, but deployed, actively enhancing somebody's life. The best example I have is I used to help the largest first-time home buyer in Mexico. They had about 4,000 salespeople, 80 or 90 offices and developments. And when I got there, I asked, what do you do? And they said, we sell first-time homes. And there's a lot more to it, but basically it was based on government financing that let somebody get in with no down payment and coordinate or correlate their payments to their income. So it was a wonderful deal. And I said, well, what does that mean? They said, what do you mean? I said, well, if somebody can do that, what's the long-term impact on their life? Turns out, basically, a lot of these blue-collar first-time buyers were living in terrible, terrible apartments and bad, bad areas. Their kids had bad influence. Their wife wouldn't go out because afraid to get raped, mugged. Or they live with their parents in their house, and the parents would treat them like they were kids, walk in on them when they're having sex, try to micromanage the kids. But when they had their own home, it was in a beautiful new area. It was safe. They felt pride. The wife was able to hang out with quality people. The kids were in an environment that was much more stimulating. They had teachers that were far more motivated than the ones that were ambivalent, been around. They also, whether they stayed in it or had someone else rented, they were building an asset that either would support them better in retirement, shorten the retirement, they could sell it for their kids and put them through college. So I had them change their reference and not say we sell houses. Every morning they'd said, how many lives are we going to transform today? Totally different shift. And their sales went because they saw what they were doing differently. You're already doing it. You probably just don't see it, and your team doesn't see it. Does that make sense? A lot of sense?
Yes.
Profound sense?
Yes.
Cool sense?
Yes.
Are you enough sense you might do something with it?
Yes.
Enough sense you're not going to take any pictures?
Yes.
Okay, cool. They make clients know that they matter. Their well-being is important. They convey that theirs is a better approach, a better way. They don't just tell, they show, they show, they show. They advocate the consumer's perspective. They reduce the hurdle rate needed to take action. This is called risk reversal. They make it easier to start a relationship. By the way, the sooner somebody buys the first time, guess what? The sooner they buy the second. The sooner they buy the second, guess what? The sooner they buy the third. And if you don't have a second or third, I can show you, if we have enough time, how to do it. It's not that hard. You already have the trust and the well-being and the connection. Okay, preeminent businesses outperform the average by big margins because they have more buyers, they have more valuable buyers, they have higher LTVs, greater viral word of mouth, profit performance usually many times that. Look at Coke versus Pepsi, Apple versus Samsung, McDonald's, Burger King, Red Bull, Monster. Just think about it. Don't you want to be on the former and not the latter? You think you can? Cool. You're going to have the PowerPoint if you don't take any pictures or take any notes. I'm looking at Trainer Mark. Don't do it. Don't do it. Anna Spathis. Don't do it. You're walking. Where are you going? Are you walking on the bridge? Okay. All the impact levers I shared, each one raises your prominence and profitability. The ads become far more profitable. Your salespeople are more impactful. The sales grow. The team transforms. They feel like they're part of a crusade, a mission. Okay, so first step, move your business from average to preeminent. Do I have your agreement?
Yes.
When are you going to do it?
Now. Not
next year, not sometime, not this is so cool, this is intellectual entertainment, back to the status quo, right? No? Good. Okay. Stay whelmed, not overwhelmed. if you don't incorporate all these characters, start with a small one. Remember, Tony's five to thrive. Okay, you ready for step two?
Yeah.
All right. Scott, you want to intervene? I think Scott went home.
No, I'm actually paying attention. I'm not taking notes.
Okay.
I'm paying attention.
All right. Am I doing all right?
You're doing great.
Thank you, sir. Okay. This is what Tony taught you. My 10, 10, 10, three ways. You ready for it to blow your mind in a level you've never comprehended and go home and go, oh, my God, I see now what I didn't before. All right. Okay. We're going to take you up a lot of notches. So you know what they are. Increasing the number of buyers, which is turbocharged if you're preeminent. Increasing the size of the transaction, turbocharged if you're preeminent. Increasing the frequency, turbocharged. So one is you get additional profit that provides when you increase the size of the sale. One is You sell more things more often. You find new profitable ways to monetize ethically your buyers. Let's look at how to do it. So what I realized is that Tony is so gracious acknowledging me, and he teaches you and he shows you the mathematical, amazing, profound impact. But I don't think you get into a lot of very specific applications. And I think that from interviewing a lot of you, that's probably to your disadvantage. So would you like me to give you a lot of very concrete applications? Okay, you're not going to take notes and you're not going to take pictures, right? Because I am going to give you about 10 applications in each of them, and they're infallible, and you don't have to do 10. All you have to do is find the one in each one that works. Okay, one, endorsers. So just some quick stories. A famous infomercial used John Ritter, who was a former comedian in a TV series many years before, and he tripled the same infomercial script just by having him on it. When Tony started, Fran Tarkenton at the time was the most visible personality on TV. He was a 3-time Super Bowl quarterback, Hall of Fame. His credibility to Tony boosted the hell out of Tony's posture when they started on TV. Tony endorsed me, and the first time we did it, we sent 20,000 letters to his list with his endorsement, cost me 10 grand and brought in 9 million. Let me say that again. Cost me 10 grand and brought in 9 million. I'm telling you what you can do. Hume Publishing was a very, very successful financial company. They had a board of advisors of prominent people who either had stature and were known, or had stature by their job or what they had done before, and they had them posted on all their ads, and their testing, I think, had quadrupled results. Icy Hot, we went and we got a guy who was a former TV star we actually started on TV with a guy we retained who was a Broadway, very prominent actor, and it bombed. We went and we found this older man who, when he was younger, represented Flash Gordon, Captain Gallant of the Foreign Legion, Tarzan, and he represented virility and health to all the people who now were 70 or 80. He was in retirement. We paid him 5 grand and an upside, and it quadrupled the results of the ad. This is supposed to be Agora and Happy Days. Happy Days was a TV show long ago, if you don't know it. It was about a hardware store guy and his family. It was very cute. The guy that was the hardware store guy, long after the series was over, they found him. They used his name and his signature on a mailing piece for a business opportunity or an entrepreneurial newsletter, and it quintupled. They're doing it without him. The George Foreman Grill. Chuck Norris did Total Gym with, I think, Christy Brinkley or somewhere, and I think they did $1 billion. Joe Namath, Medicare. I just allowed a company called Consulting.com to test using me. I get half of the upside if my brand works, and it's a quality company that helps smaller consultants become bigger. You can do it too. It doesn't matter if you do it local. Everyone can find somebody who has stature, either that's known or what they do or did is credible enough that it lifts, and you can test it. Does that make sense?
Yes. Cool.
Risk reversal. Do you understand what risk reversal is? It's making it easier to say yes than no. When Nordstrom started, I don't know if they still do it, they said, if you're dissatisfied with any purchase for any time, for any reason, you can have a credit. You can have a refund. You can have a replacement. No questions asked. When FedEx started, they said, delivered to your door by 10 tomorrow morning, guaranteed, or your money back. When Domino's started, they said, hot, fresh, delicious pizza delivered to your door in 30 minutes or less, or it's yours free. Martial arts basically lets you often do 4 or 6 weeks gratis, and they even give you the uniform. I had a seminar that was $20,000. We sold $23 million worth in about 6 months, and we basically wouldn't even let them pay for it until they first got a $2,000 course that we said would make them enough money to pay for it. Then it was 5 days. We wouldn't cash their check or process the credit card till they had first gone through 50% of the whole thing. So a lot of ways you can do it, and I have a lot of detailed work on it because there's 5 directions you can take it. I don't have, and again, I'm not trying to tease you. I got too much to go through. I don't have the time to do it now, but I think it's something you all need to play with, because I've seen it double. I've seen it 50% just by having a stronger risk reversal. And just saying money back guaranteed is not, just saying 30 days is not. You can take it much more dimensional, much more visual. I could show you, but I have too much to do right now, but maybe we could do it with somebody in the process with Tony. Bonuses. Okay, bonuses work when you're hiring talent. Bonuses work when you're incentivizing salespeople. Bonuses work when you're selling to people. Think about anything you ever bought where they give you a bonus. Sports Illustrated used to give you either a chair or the swimsuit edition or a radio or something. Technology, arcade. I created a massive success. I had a client, an arcade under a boardwalk where there were about 100 vendors, and they were not getting enough people that came, but we started analyzing lifetime value, what a buyer was worth. We found that everybody that came down spent a minimum of $10, an average of up to $25. So we went up to all the vendors and we gave them certificates good for $1 of play. No questions asked. These were quarters. They could give it to anybody that spent a minimum, and they did, and about a third of them came down, and every time they redeemed the dollar, they spent $9 to $19 more. Seminars. A lot of seminars give you a lot of bonuses. Newsletters. Anybody subscribe to a newsletter? Well, newsletters sell mostly on the bonus, because newsletters are deferred gratification. They're going to give you all these great insights, recommendations, advice down the pike. So how do they get you excited now? They give you a bonus, a report of the 7 top stocks you can invest now, or the 25 things you can do to boost your energy, reduce your cholesterol right away. That's a bonus. Podcasts. Podcasts are a way you can increase your business. Dave Asprey built Bulletproof Coffee to $150 or so million by having Bulletproof Radio and becoming a voice of biohacking. Board of advisors, you put them on the front. You basically make them very, very prominent. You get people who either are known, or their past or their current position gives you such prestige against your competitors that don't. Having blogs that people write, organizing discussion groups. Referral strategies, operative word is strategies. Anybody that knows me knows that I have, in the course of my career, identified 125. That is a 1, a 2, and a 5 different referral generating strategies or systems that anybody can apply. Most people who are in a business where referrals and word of mouths are key don't even have one. They don't have one that's regularly adhered to besides, I hope you'll give me referrals, I'll give you $10 or a bottle of wine. That's not the stuff we're talking about. We're talking about formal, strategic, very sophisticated stuff. Imagine if you only had 3, if you have none now, and you had predictable, sustainable, high-quality, rapid-closing referrals. And what I tell people who get a lot of their business from referrals, it's a what's wrong with this picture. So, very fascinating, very fascinating. So, if you run ads anywhere and you get a response, that's the outer periphery of trust. That person, unless they know you well, is going to be very apprehensive. It's going to take a lot to move them to a purchase commitment. Even when they purchase, it's going to be tentative because they still don't know how you'll deliver. But a referral-generated buyer buys quickly, negotiates less, buys more, trusts immediately, buys more things more often, is more enjoyable to deal with. Oh, and by the way, costs you nothing to acquire. Oh, and by the way, they refer more people. So do you think there's something wrong if you don't have referral strategies working for you? Good. Okay, so real estate does it. Network marketing does it. Tesla is grown. Service company. Anybody ever been in a leads group? Raise your hand. Did it work? Did you get any business from it? How much? It's only $3,000-$4,000 to join, isn't it? It's not very much, is it? Who got something good from a leads group? Nobody? It's where people come together and they tell about each other and then they refer people, business owners. Does it work? So let me tell you what most people don't understand. People don't understand you have something called free will. You know what free will means? It means if you've ever been in a leads group or a mastermind group and it's produced for you not just knowledge, but business, You don't have to wait to find one and pay for it. You can organize your own, or five of your own, or 20 of your own, and you can go into your community. You can do it virtually. You can organize leads groups, not charge people, bring 40, 50 non-competitive businesses together. You orchestrate it. You're the focal hub. You pay for everything, or not breakfast, but everything else. They love you. Now you're getting leads, but you're also getting stature. I've got clients that maybe have 15 of them, and when it gets out of their realm, they end up hiring someone to run it. Does that make sense? I'm trying to get you to think differently. Am I getting you to think differently? Am I keeping you connected? I'm not checking to see if any of you are taking notes. Are you taking notes? Taking pictures? Are you covertly going, do you have like a camera in your lapel? In your hat? You have a camera in your hat? Do you? Turn it off. Okay, increase the number of buyers. You acquire products and services they buy before, during, and after, so you get a lot more people starting. If you know that I'm going to do, anybody here in home improvement? So we used to help all kinds of home improvement, and it was hilarious because most people in home improvement sell one thing. You guys may sell many, but here's what happens. Normally, when you're improving your house or condo, the first thing you do is a kitchen, right? Usually, not always, but I would say 80%. So you get this beautiful kitchen, and guess what? The rest of the house looks like So what do you do next? Bathrooms? Okay, now the bathrooms look great when you're in it. The kitchen's great. Living room, closets, pretty bad. So then your closets. So then looks pretty good, but the walls are dingy, so you paint, you do carpet. And now the inside looks pretty damn good. What do you do next? Garage door, landscaping, roof, hardscaping. Guess what? If people are going to do that, and there's a correlation, if you had a relationship with those, or you just advertised for them so you could find the next level, and you charged a piece for the lead, or, I mean, do you understand the correlation? It's amazing, and most people just think very linear about the one thing they do. Compete with yourself. I talk about the fact that anybody here ever tried to lose weight, raise your hand. Did anyone basically try to do it? You don't have to do it with your hands because I want to be fast. So let's say you took a supplement. Two things normally happen. Most people are not just taking a supplement. They're doing something concurrently. Second, most people don't take it very long because it doesn't work for them if they don't follow the protocol, just like this won't work for you if you don't follow the protocol. So they'll try a different supplement. But if you basically compete against yourself because you've already acquired the asset, you don't have any more investment. You could have other supplements. You could sell portion control food. You could have trainers. You can sell equipment. You can sell virtual group training because they're going to buy it anyhow. Do you understand that? You've got the asset. You've already got the sunk cost in that asset. You can barter. DHL, when they started out, went to all the TV, radio, and media people, and they traded their services for advertising. So they had a high margin, and they ended up, I think they traded $10 million to start with because they knew besides getting advertising at a much steeper discount, they didn't have to pay for it right now, but they got it right now because they gave them a credit that could be used for 2 years, so they had a deferred payment. So if you bought it for cash, you'd have to give cash now. They bought it on barter. They got the advertising now. They paid it at a discount, probably about 70%. They had basically a 2-year loan interest free, so they had the time value of money. And when the barter expired, the stations were hooked on DHL. They didn't go back to FedEx. I traded, if you come to my house, I've got a NSX I've got a G-Wagon I traded for, I got a Maserati with a tricked out Ferrari engine I traded for, it's a convertible, I got a Porsche I traded for, I had a Bentley I traded for, I had muscle cars I traded for, I've got $2 million of art I traded for, I got a new driveway I traded for, because I get like 100 and something a day, so it's not hard to trade, but you can trade what you got, if it's desirable, for what you need. We have car dealer. Anybody a car dealer here? Raise your hand. Big. What do you do? What model? Which one? Okay. Well, you have a big operation. Okay. So I've done profit centers with car dealers where we'd look at a bit. Most people don't know, understand a new car dealer spends an effing fortune on stuff. You think it's just all profit. I mean, they buy parts, they buy people washing the windows, they buy, you know, chemicals. We would find everything they would buy, and we would go to people and offer to trade 2-to-1 the car at twice its value for the product or service they were paying cash for. We'd go to a different vendor. And when we did that, instead of getting a 15% or whatever the margin is, we'd get double that. Sometimes we'd be able to trade a lease car we took back, but we would save millions of dollars. It's a really cool concept. It takes more time. Sheraton traded with companies all the time to get free advertising, and when the advertising expired, all their executives for all the radio TV stations were used to staying there. The Palm Springs, California Tourist Bureau trades all of their advertising, and you have to use the credit in Palm Springs so it all recycles back. You have to go to and use Palm Springs vendors. Doesn't matter what you buy, it has to be purchased in Palm Springs. Semantics, this is so cool. I'm going to be very fast. True story. Friend of mine was considered the barter baron. He traded billions of dollars, and he taught me a very fascinating mindset when you understand possibilities. Many years ago, Mazda came to the United States, and they introduced a piece of you-know-what car called the RX-7. Everybody know what that was? It was a piece of wasn't it? And it was underpowered. It leaked. Didn't sell well. They had about $50 million of retail inventory sitting, rusting and dusting on the harbor warehouse. My friend wanted to trade them for radio advertising and TV advertising nationally they could use for the new model. He gets an appointment with the president, who was from Japan. True story. Goes there all excited. He says, I will trade you the $50 million of cars that aren't selling for $50 million of prime network TV and radio you can use for the new model coming out in the fall. That's really cool. The president said, I wish I could, but if I did, I'd like to. But he said I'd lose face both in Japan and with Detroit. And he sent my friend on his way. He gets on what's called the 405 in California, the road. The guy's driving around. He goes, turns around, asks if he could have 5 minutes. Says, let me ask you a different question. If I buy $50 million of cars from you, would you buy $50 million of ads from me? And he said, sure. So semantics sometimes is the key. True story. Increase the buyer. I told you digital, social media. I showed you all the levers in SEO. Is this fun? Buy media differently. So we did ICO. We didn't pay. We paid on result. We gave people more than 100% of the first sale because we had so many repeats, and we were every time we sold 10 people a $3 jar. It was mail order when we started. We made $50 a person every year in profit, so we could pay a ton up front, and the cash flow came back within about 2 weeks. I call it the unlimited business check, but the guy, Chuck McDowell, anybody ever listen to CNN, Fox, CNBC, Bloomberg on Sirius Satellite or watch it at home? Not many. There's a man on there all the time with a Southern draw who is the world leading company in timeshare contract cancellation. You know what that is? He is my client. When I met him, he was doing about $35 million. He's doing now about $150. When I met him, he was making about $800,000. He's got his own jet. He's got a 20,000 square foot house on one of the beautiful city oceans here. He's got another 5,000 house behind it. He lives in, what's the really beautiful place? Franklin, Tennessee. He has put naming rights on the VIP part of the Titans. He is making, I think, probably $20 million. And the way he did it was, I have a friend who knows how to buy media. It's called last-minute media. You buy it at the last minute when it's not sold, and you get it for 80 or 90% off. And basically, you could maybe make no profit when you're paying 100%, but all of a sudden, if you're only paying 10 or 15, it changes, and that was the driver. It says sex over 40. It's not meant to shock you. There was a newsletter many years ago that had it was a psychiatrist, and he had very clinical stuff helping people older have better sex with their partner. And he would run full-page ads in the newspapers on the front of sections, and they would break even, meaning he'd get back what he paid, which was okay because he wanted the renewal and he had other ancillary ways to upsell. But I knew I could buy that same newspaper for 80% off. So I made a deal with him where I got all the arbitrage. I got, if it broke even at 100% and I could buy it for 20, I made every time I ran an ad, I made 50 or 100 grand. There's a lot of things like that, strategic communication. Most people don't know that how you say or do things make a total difference. They're measurable difference, 2, 3, 5 times different. Co-branding, you can find somebody with prestige and brand it just to get the front end, the first sale. Downselling, if you can't sell them what you want, you sell something else. Years ago, I had a client in Australia, one of the early entries into CRM. They had a very expensive CRM. They ran ads in all the trade magazines. You still got a half hour. I'm rushing this, but is this making sense? Hopefully it's fun, isn't it? I'm trying to pummel you with ways to use the 10-10-10, not just be excited, but put it to work. So they were selling a very expensive CRM. They ran ads in all the trade magazines. Sorry, I look straight out. I'll look at all you also. And they were getting about 1,000 leads a month, and they were spending about $100,000 to do it. And I said to them, what's your conversion? It was 3%. That means they were wasting $97,000 a month. Think about it. I usually carry $5,000 in my pocket and throw it on the ground so people can see the graphic. I've got it in my room somewhere, but I didn't bring it. I said, well, people, it's pretty boring, so people aren't inquiring about it because they don't want CRM. You're either too expensive, your terms aren't good, too complex. Why don't you find somebody who's got a basic entry version that's a good program or a good service, but it's, you could add some bells and whistles and give them a royalty and then customize it, do a white label, and sell that as a downsell. They did it, and they started making tons more from the people they originally didn't sell than they did the ones they did. And the ones they did sell that were like 50 grand were all profit. It's just changing your referential mindset. Does that make sense? Try to show you how to use this. AI research that'll tell you all kinds of opportunities. Better copy sales scripts. We tested, just as an example, one time. Well, first of all, I've seen a change in headline produce up to 21 times better response. And a headline's not just a headline. It's the subject line. It's what a salesperson says in the first half, you know, a half minute or 5 minutes. It's what you say when you're manning a booth at a trade show. It's the signage. Anybody do trade show advertising? Raise your hand. So let me ask you this. What's wrong with this picture? So if somebody doesn't know you and it says the Abraham Group on the top, does that really attract somebody? If it said, you know, how to find hidden assets, overlooked opportunities, multiply the performance of everything you do for nothing and make at least 10 times more profit in the next year, would that stop you? So people don't understand that changing the message, we tested one time 33 ways of greeting somebody at the front door of a very large furniture chain, and one of them tripled conversion. You probably want to know what it is, don't you? Is that what you're raising your hand for? I can't hear you. Now get a mic. Wait, boom, 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 boom. Racing against the clock. Da-dun, da-dun, da-dun. Is this fun? Cool. Is this fun, virtual people? And thank you, hello, Trainer Mark, for not taking pictures.
Thank you for being here. It's amazing how simple everything is.
It is. That's what I was mandated by Tony. Give them something simple that if they don't do it, they are going to be ashamed of themselves.
So all these days have been excellent for me because I wasn't doing anything.
Okay.
I grow my business organically. I have a small tax preparation firm. I help people start their companies, do their taxes, set up for their accounting.
Okay, so what's your question?
All right, so the question is, someone at the local Staples said, hey, we'll let you put a table here, you know, and we'll set it up for you. And I did.
And?
It wasn't effective. All because all I did was put my company name, the products we serve, and, you know.
Yeah, well, I mean, so is that, are you acknowledging it? Are you asking? I can't understand. Is
I'm
it
acknowledging a, it.
Yeah,
I'm,
thank you.
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, but honestly, I will be humiliated if 90% of what I'm saying today isn't crystal clear to you. Is it? And I will be not humiliated, I will be disgusted if at least some portion isn't acted upon. You think it will be?
Yes.
Promise?
Yes.
Because you can review the entire PowerPoint and all that I don't, and maybe at a break they'll let me do more if I don't get done. Multiple perspectives. I have seen that when you're communicating, if you do it two different ways, you'll get the same audience to respond, because some people don't respond to the first proposition or hot button and they will to the other. I have a relationship with a very prominent educator in the dental community, and we have three masterminds. We had none before. He always wanted to do one. He couldn't get one person. I created 13 totally different sequential emails he sent in cycles every couple of days, and then we did it again, and each one addressed the attributes of the mastermind from different vantage points: the collegial, the knowledge, the understanding of how the average person would elevate their income. We're doing it at a magnificent 28,000 square foot. It's an estate, but he calls it the Chateau outside of D.C. We showed all the people that have benefited. I just keep doing, and the first time we did it, he got a few. The second time, a few more. The second time, a few more. Now we sold out three because we kept going at it. A lot of people, one premise isn't enough to move them. Think about yourself. How many in this room have something in their business or life you probably need to take action on, which means purchase, engage, but you aren't motivated enough from whatever it has done to move you to final commitment? Raise your hand. Well, do you think it's any different with the audience you're addressing? Give them every perspective. There's a funny adage. You all know what Baskin-Robbins is? So it's funny, but it's a good metaphor. So if the world only liked vanilla, there wouldn't be a Baskin-Robbins, would there? Think about it, okay? I already made that point. New math. When you understand, I'm introduced, but you don't understand allowable acquisition cost. The moment you understand what relative value leads are worth, certain kinds of buyers are worth, salespeople are worth, now you understand. So I understand that if I get, well, I'll give you an example. We have a $25,000 3-day event we do, and it generates 200,000 and 300,000 base fee clients that give me a percentage. It's usually 25%. We have a mastermind that is $50,000, but it's designed to get to critical mass so we can buy and sell businesses and have basically a de facto private equity. I realize that the $25,000 static 3-day is a big, big source for the 48,000, because we get between 50 and 80% to convert. And the mastermind is infinitely more strategically and wealth generatingly important. So now we'll spend up to 20,000 of the 25,000 to get the right person, because I don't care about that. I care about moving him or her into the next, which is the mastermind. And I care about getting them to help us develop a private equity firm. So you have to figure out what somebody is worth. In Icy Hot, we grew from nothing to 500,000 buyers in a very rapid order, because we were able to figure out that every time we got 10 buyers for $3, 8 of them bought every month for almost ever, until somebody got a cure for arthritis. Of the 8 that bought, almost half bought something else. Of the half that bought something else, I'm going fast. If you don't understand, I'll try to repeat. 2 of them would buy bulk twice a year for gifts. Bottom line is, every time we got 10 people at $3, we made $50 profit a year on everybody, including the 2 that didn't buy. With that knowledge, we went to all the media and we gave them more than the $3 to get us the first sale. In truth, we could have given them $49 out of the $50 we would have made in year one and still made out like bandits in year 2 and 3 and 4. But when you know what different kinds of buyers are worth, you cannot spend, you can invest an unlimited amount. up to a certain amount, you have an unlimited budget as long as you have the cash. And if you don't have the cash and you can project out the yield, you can get a hard money investor to do it for you because you can give them infinitely more on interest and a piece of the... Does that make sense or am I confusing you? So know what it is. Break even on the front end. A lot of people don't make money on the front end. They want to make it easy and they put all their money in either advertising, bonuses, price cuts, sales commissions to incentivize. Quick story, because it's very important. So I had a client years ago, I told the story a lot if you've heard me, fluid transmission, the plastic pipe used in manufacturing to move chemicals and bottling for syrup, in agriculture for irrigation, and they wanted a breakthrough. They had no money. They were regional. I asked them to tell me what their lifetime value, their allowable cost, they didn't know. So we did an analysis. They had, I think they had 5 or 10 salespeople. Doesn't matter, the essence is the same. They found out that every time they got a first-time new buyer, they were worth $200 profit. Just look at profit. Every time they got a first, this is always worst case. You never look at best case. Every time they got a first-time new buyer, it was 5 sales a year at $200. Every time they got one, they'd stay on average, worst case, 3 years. So every time they got a new first-time buyer, it was worth $3,000. Am I going too fast? I said, what are you paying your salespeople? It was 10% of the commission of the profit. I said, I'll bet your salespeople never really generate a lot of new buyers. They said, they don't. I said, because they're linear two-dimensional thinkers. They just look at 10% of 200 is $20. It's not exciting. I said, why don't you go to them and say, as long as you keep your volume up to where it's average with your existing clients, we'll give you 100% of the first profit. And there were two brothers who said, they always said, why would we want to give away $180 of our profit? And I said, you're not. You're investing $180 you never had for the 90% of the $2,800 you will have. They did it, and the salespeople grew 5 times their accounts. Does this make sense? I call it new math, knowing the golden numbers. See, what does it cost to acquire? What are they worth? It gives you the answers. What can you invest, not spend, for the yield? I mean, you're not going to get any better yield on anything you invest in, your portfolio, capital equipment, than this when you understand it. Pretty exciting, isn't it, Eric? Am I doing okay? You sure? Okay, Eric said, you better do well or I'm going to be embarrassed. Okay, all right. Okay, increase the size of the transaction. How do you do it? First thing is you improve your sales team's ability. There you can improve yours. Okay, like radio stations, I went to radio stations that had a big group. I had a client that had 400 salespeople. We started to analyze who's better at opening accounts, who's better at keeping accounts, who's better at selling other things after they start, who's better at selling different. And we changed around and we brought the people that were better together and we tried to learn what did they do differently. It's called, I call it PEQ, Performance Enhancement Quotient Optimization. There's a process. But we move the people that were better. Sometimes in a market, somebody may be 5 times better than somebody else at selling car dealers, but they got one car dealer in their audience. We would send them around and make them the car dealer specialist. Somebody might have been better at retaining clients. We made that person that. Somebody might be better at opening. Give you a very simple, true story. A colleague of mine was a client, and they came to a $25,000 program years ago. Two of them did. One of them ran the largest Mercedes dealer and the most profitable of its kind on the West Coast. And when he learned what I just said to you a different way, he went back and he made a startling realization. Where's the car dealer? Did he leave? He missed the best part. He's going to go, oh, when he comes back, go, you missed the best part. And Jay said, it's not to be recorded. It's not included on the PowerPoint. Jeez, here's the deal. In the car business, once you buy the car and you think you're sailing verily out the door, then they send you to what's called F&I, finance and insurance. And then somehow you walk out with $10,000 of tire protection and your car never needs to be waxed and you got a 20-year extended warranty and you're just feeling pretty cool, right? It's only $35 more a month for life. And that is often more profit to the dealer than the sale. And this guy went back, and after he learned this, he realized, Jesus, I have 2 people doing it, 1 during the day and 1 at night and weekends. The day was getting most of the business. The night was getting about a fourth. But he realized the night guy was averaging $2,500 worth of profit every deal, and the daytime one was $1,800, $700 different. Just by changing their schedule, he made another $180,000 a month. It's not that hard. Is this all making sense? Who's seeing that you've got a lot of assets you can command, demand a lot more yield from? It's all about yield. It's not about spending. It's about investing. You are an investor. Being preeminent, you'll increase it. It's just because you're more powerful. You'll sell more. When you're preeminent, you do not let people buy less than they should in less quantity, quality, consistency. Not because you want all the profit, but because you know they will be deserved. I'll never forget when the first big screen TVs came out. I went to Best Buy, and the guy sold me the cheapest one because he wanted to just get it out. I got home, and it didn't have all the bells and whistles. It didn't have all the level of whatever it is, resolution. It didn't have the surround sound. And I was pissed because I would rather have spent. I wanted all those things, but I didn't know they were possible. You have a moral obligation to tell people what you feel is in their best interest and why and what will serve them better. And then if they don't want to do it, it is their prerogative. But if you don't help them make a better decision, you're stealing opportunity, results, enjoyment, protection from them. Does that make sense? It's a very powerful distinction. Okay. Selling not just products, but packaging services. We're trying to raise the size of the sale and thus the profit. I'm fixated on profit, not top line. You don't have to be fixated on a 10-time moonshot, dangerous, very, very speculative deal if you can have a 10-time bottom line. My friend, Dr. Alan Bernard, he's the world authority on theory of constraint. You'll hear about him later on from Scott. But he's got a philosophy he calls it top line, bottom line. You should be trying to get turn your top line into your bottom line in 4 years or less. He rarely does it, but oftentimes he hits it by about 60%. And I've got a quote that I'll give you at the end if I have time. You shift up market, you create services, supplement support packages you can add, VIP services. I mean, Tony's got gradients that he has. You're a VIP, you pay more, you sit up front. All of a sudden, you make three times as much from the same person in a room just by reconstituting. You get a few more tchotchkes and bonuses. Lifetime. You could sell somebody a lifetime or a modified. When I was in the newsletter business, I created lifetime subscriptions. And then the people that didn't buy it, we sold a half life. And the ones that didn't do it, we gave them deals on 3 years. Larger units of purchase. That's what a Costco or a Sam Club's does. Signature specialty. Anybody know what the Eddie Bauer, what was it? It was a Ford. Do you remember that? Anybody know what the Breitling Bentley is? It's a signature watch. Anybody know what an AMG is? Anybody know that Target basically bought the rights to Massimo so they could charge double what they make for the same, piece of clothing they make in China or Vietnam? They just put his name on it? Okay, perceived value. My friend, who is the former senior strategic advisor to Texas Pacific Group, huge, like the third largest PE firm either in the country or the world. They used to own Neiman's. They own all kinds of companies, Burger King, Five Day Energy, wineries. And he said, you go into Neiman's and there's one piece on the rack. You want that because it's the only piece there. No, they have 40 of them in the back room. And when that one piece comes out, they put another one out. So they can command the price, okay? Peter Diamandis only allows 300 or so people to his 360. Do you think he couldn't find a venue that would accommodate 500? But maybe if it was too available, it wouldn't be that desirable. Wine clubs make you get on the list before you get their newest vintage. Harlan, anybody on the Harlan wine list? Anybody buy from Harlan? Raise your hand. It's hard to even get on it. Ferrari, anybody own a Ferrari? Want to trade? I like Ferraris. I used to have a 512 and a 308, the last aspirated 308 GT. Great. Anyhow, Ferrari, can you just buy any Ferrari you want? What do you have to do? Get a start? You got to be on the waiting list. That's how they come in. Do they discount? No. Okay, all-inclusive. You can be all-inclusive. Resorts, Disneyland, buffets, spas, movie bundles, Netflix. You can have tiered pricing, apartments, condos, views, floors, restaurant seating. We had a restaurant that would pre-sell tables. So you pay 10 grand. Every time you get there, it doesn't matter how busy they are. You get in and you get your table. And you get also, I think, 12 grand or 15 grand of purchases. They get a bigger sale. They get more profit. Most people take forever to do it, so it costs them less because prices go up in the time value of money. This is the third, mastering the size. First of all, you master upselling and you program people. You don't program people Svengali-like or like Jim Jones in Guyana. If you're preeminent, you program them to start at the beginning knowing that to get the best outcome, they should buy everything ongoing, or you program that you're going to be their most trusted advisor for life, and you're going to be there to provide them with all the products or services they need throughout the process, the ups, the downs, the growth, whatever it is. Buy two, get one half price. Doesn't matter as long as you have a sustainable infinite capacity to produce. It matters what the profit per transaction is. I gave you the extended warranty. Testimonial support. It's how you increase the transaction. Well, are we still on transaction size? Let's see. I thought we were on frequency. Let's see if I screwed myself up. I'm not. We're still on. That's okay. I'm screwed up because I'm trying to rush through it. Testimonials. The man told you there is a correlation. The more reviews you have, the more people trust and buy faster and more, and they negotiate less. The more testimonials you've got, the same thing. The more endorsers you've got relative to your market, the same thing. There's an asymmetric correlation. Data, statistical research that verified. There's a great, great, great way of doing things, and I'll tell you the quick story. There was a very, very unsuccessful company years ago selling prints, major prints of art, and they didn't do well with their normal approach, and then they changed it. They changed their whole position to say what you can have in common with the Met, the Louvre, a bunch of other. They got you to see that they have the originals on their wall, and you can have it on your wall, and that shift got people to buy many more things. Risk reversal. You can use risk reversal to encourage people to buy again or more or different things after the first sale and give them enough encouragement that if it doesn't produce, if it doesn't pay off, if they don't like it, you know, you'll take it back. You'll give them a credit as long as you can afford to. And I actually have a way that you can use risk reversal if you're a real estate agent, and it's really mind-blowing, but I don't have time now, but maybe we will. Give steep discounts, which is counterintuitive. But let's just look at it at the bottom. So if one is a dollar, excuse me, if buying one is $100 and you have a $50 markup, buy three for $79, you're going to get a profit of $75. If it's five for $69, you're going to get a profit of $95. So as long as you have a capacity to keep producing and it doesn't unintentionally forward advance future purchases, that's a great way to do it. Impact analysis. What Rob, my vice president of profit partnerships does, and it's some of you might want to have a relationship, he'll sit down with you and say, let's do an impact analysis of what the minimum impact would be if you do this. And it works 50%, 100%. We have a colleague that does that he's got a service that sets up high-level appointments with CEOs for people. He charges $200,000-$300,000. The first thing he does is show people the minimum impact. It'll be in dollars. And if they're a public company, the minimum impact, if they do it, it'll be on their stock price. And he closes like about 60%. Impact analysis are very, very important. Offering a bonus when over a discount. That's another way to increase it. The dating service example, and this is funny. So if you have statistical data to say that the average person who has two dates is not going to be as successful as the one that has 20, and you charge per booking or lunch, it's in their best interest, but it's better for them to buy 20 whatever connections than three. And I'm not purporting to be your Tinder coach, but I'm just trying to show you that you can use data to really get people to buy more because it's in their best interest and make more profit. Okay, now it's the third way. Sell more things more often. Find more utility value if you have nothing else to sell from people who already bought. You have a sunk cost in that asset. You understand it? If you can pull a lot more out of it, 19 more minutes. Pressure. We're going to play Billy Joel? No. Anyhow, you can develop a back end of your own, even if you don't have it. Don't have to own it. You can get rights to something. You can private label. You can partner. If you only have one part of the puzzle and you know they buy a lot of other things, as after that, why would you not want to have a right to do it? If you're their most trusted advisor, you can find the best provider. You can negotiate the best deal. You could be their ombudsman. And you could make maybe four times more from that sale than you make right now. Because if it's one-time status, why do that? You have a trusted relationship. You've already got the sunk cost to acquire the asset. Syndicate. Get other people to provide stuff for you. Partner with complementary products. I just said that. Private label, where something's perpetual. Expand your distribution channels, where you're getting people to buy more things through other people. What else? Do your clients buy? This is profound. Most people think the only thing they can sell is what they sell. They don't understand if you have a trusted relationship and it's a human being and he or she basically runs a department and they buy a lot more things, or they are a human being that has a life and they worry about finances, taxes, health, relationships, you really could sell a lot more things to them just what you sell because you've already earned their trust. And you're doing them a service if you're not taking advantage. Special client-only purchase events where it's only available to them. They get access to something nobody else does. That's how you get repeat sales, make them feel important. You get access or early access, whatever you do. Advance, okay, programming people, I already said that, at the point of sale. Price inducements for frequency. Benefit bonus inducements for frequency. So stop limiting your buy of what else they buy. I mean, I've seen people go to their audience and sell all kinds of things outside of the rigid constraints of their product or service category once they had a trusted relationship because it was a human being. Could have been just somebody who's a decision maker in a business that's buying a lot more product services or should. I mean, any of you a consultant or any kind of a single topic expert, raise your hand. A lot. So here's a reality check. Pardon my voice. When I go fast, it goes. So usually, it may not be your experience, but most single topic experts work their ass off to get the gig, whether it's a consulting, an on-site, whatever it would be, and it's profitable. And then when it's done and you've popped your cork, you have a lot more to sell them. Maybe it's new people coming in. Maybe it's upgrade. But it's limited. But you've worked your ass off. You've taught them an expertise that theoretically is producing either greater revenue, profit, savings, cash flow management, logistics management, whatever. So they trust you. You have made an economic impact of a positive nature. If you go back to them and say, hey, I know this guy named Jay Abraham. He can grow your business in other ways. Hey, I know this sales trainer. Hey, I know this guy who can find your biggest constraint. Whatever the expert is who doesn't have that relationship, who may never get that trust, you could get half of their revenue in most cases, not mine, but most cases, and you'd be doing them a service. Does that make sense? Isn't this an interesting mindset shift? I call it a paradigmectomy. Loyalty programs. We call it the loyalty royalty. It's like you get a royalty all the time. Data intelligence, Amazon. People who buy this, buy that. All you do is ask them. Ask your clients, what else do you buy? If somebody's in charge of IT, what other things are you responsible for? What are the problems you're trying to solve? What are the opportunities you guys are working on? Are you a human being? Do you have any other interests? You got stress? You worry about weight? You want to have a better relationship? What do you want? This is interesting. See what it says, ducks? I have a client, fascinating client. They are the world's largest and the North America's largest provisioner of ducks. They sell over 50% of every Asian restaurant ducks. They sell 80% of the Michelin restaurants. When I met them, they were doing 335 million or 30 million. Now they're doing 250 million. And all the sons who are about 30 to 35 have been sequestered by the father for me to basically do a one-year, very unique mentorship to teach them the three things that the father used to grow the business. One was strategy preeminence. The other was the power Parthenon, which I hope I can teach you in 13 minutes. The other is variability. And one more thing. And I started looking at their business. They do 250 million. They only have five salespeople. Each salesperson is responsible for an area that includes retail, restaurants, high-end, low-end, provisioners, distributors, institutional. And so I said, okay, so let's divide five into 250. So each one's responsible for $50 million. How much gross profit is that? It's about 20 million, it's 40%. I said, what do you pay them? They get paid about $110,000, including bonus. I said, I think there's something wrong with this picture. Let me tell you what it is. Do they have time to help every restaurant sell more, you know, play around with menus that might change the buying, work with all the people on the trucks, work with, no. Do they have time to work with the biggest? No. I said, so you're saying 100, what is 100,000 to 20 million? Then I asked the CEO, do you ever invest in a capital equipment? Well, sure. What's your payback? 20% a year. I said, so if you got 100,000 generating 20 million and you know there's probably another 20 million sitting they don't have time for, do you think maybe putting another 100,000 into that market would yield, even if it wasn't linear, if it was less, if it was only 10 million for 100,000 a year and it's basically, what is that, 100 to 1? I said, duh. Does that make sense? Are you starting to think differently about really, ROI on equipment, I just said that. On site, somebody that I know is the national sales manager for Behr Paint. They want to make sure their paint sells more and more often, so they have full-time people in all the Home Depots. And people do that in Costco. And it says Paragon Honda. That's the Honda dealer. We realized you could put salespeople in service. And somebody's in service and they have one of three scenarios. One, they get a bill if they want to do it that's way more than they thought to fix their car. Two, they have a car that's beautiful for its vintage, low miles, and it's gorgeous. Three, they don't really want to keep the car they've got or the payments as well. We have 8 or 10, I don't remember what he's got now, salespeople right there in service generating $1 million a month. $1 million a month of repeat sales just by either trading them up, out, telling them why spend the $5,000 to repair it. We'll give you that. We'll take it as is, give you the full value of it, and get you into something different. And most people don't think about that's a great way to get people that are buying one time, buying another time, and another. Compete against yourself. I told you that, the weight loss example. Okay? So Mercedes dealership, they have new, they have used, any dealership. They have service, they have parts, they have body shop. Guess what? It gets more frequent buyers. Understanding margin and net worth. We talked about that, allowable cost. You're an investor versus spending. Okay, the advanced three ways. This is cool. You ready? I have never done this PowerPoint. I've never concentrated on short and mid-range. I've never tried to give you such an infallible and an inarguable case for doing right away. Did I do it? Okay, let's continue. Thank you, Scott. Okay, this is so cool. You already know the three ways. Now let's take it to a higher level. Let's put it on steroids, okay? Okay, you know the 10, 10, 10. Now we're going to add 10, 10, 10, 10, 10, 10. Okay, the first, penetrate a new market every year or a new category or a new media. that you can access that either you have never or your competitor and you have never. I'll give you an example. Cox Cable, I have. They started with cable. Then they got Wi-Fi. Now they have cell. Same thing for Verizon. Tesla started here, then went to China, then had a budget version. Now they're getting a truck. They have a branded battery. I have a client, ex-client, accountants world. They had services for accountant with a client, with compliance, just doing the regular stuff you do at tax time. Then they added payroll. Then they added doing recruiting for accountants. Sports owners that max out on a football team go then and they buy a team in the UK. Verticals. I basically took my training when I was doing it. After doing it general, I took it to the dental market. We did like 800 dentists at one time. We did martial arts. We did real estate. We did chiropractors. Introduce a new product every year. Tony started with UPW. Then he went to Date with Destiny. Then he went, I don't know if it's the right order, Business Mastery, Wealth Mastery, Life Mastery, Platt, Lion, Money Management, Mergers and Acquisitions. He's got interest in 150 or so businesses, Health Longevity. He was able to access the same audience for much of that. You happen to be part of the same audience. So you're a living, breathing validation of the power and the profitability of this. Does that make sense? Cool. Amazon started with books, then infinite products, grocery, Whole Foods, distribution, AWS Cloud, Ring, Prime Video, photos, advertising, home services, publishing. Oh, wow. You know what this is? Coke. Look at all the brands they've got besides Coke. They're penetrating every market they can, including coffee, including sparkling water, including mixers, orange juice. Oh, Marriott. You have any idea all the brands Marriott owns? Am I making my point? Deeply, impenetrably, and, you know, inarguably, inextricably? I like those words. Okay, number three, acquire every year a business, a product, a service, a sales force, a podcast, a discussion group, somebody's URL. I'm going to go fast because a lot more. Good example, somebody licensed a deal with King's Hawaiian Bread to do cookies under the brand. It took off, so they bought it. Do you know the story of Bill Gates and Paul Allen and MS-DOS? They didn't create it. They bought it for $50,000, supposedly. $50,000 into how many billions? How many billions? What's the ROI on that, Eric? It's infinite almost. Okay, whichever way you use advanced three ways, they still fall under the three ways. Imagine the advanced three ways are an exponential way to drive the 10-10-10. Okay, you ready for a cool one? Are we having reality check, reality check? And you're going, oh, my God, I got to go home right now. I got to go to Jay and have him retain him for the big bucks because he's so cool, right? No? I can't wait to get the PowerPoint. I'm not going to take any more pictures. You're very cute, but don't take pictures, okay? All right. This is so powerful, honest to God. When I show you this, you're going to go jaw drop. Okay, it's the most logical method of revenue enhancement you'll ever apply. How many of you drive all your business from one basic revenue stream? Let's do it graphically. Sorry, you guys on the screen, if I don't acknowledge you, I'll acknowledge you now. Jeremiah Hafer, Tammy McDonald, Linda Lay, just so you know that I'm seeing you. Okay, how many of you stand up if your business is driven by word of mouth only? Stand up. Just stand up for a minute. Okay, look around the room. Sit down. How many by Salesforce, internal, external, captive, contract? One. Only one. Interesting. Two. Thank you. Okay, how about digital marketing? Stand up. Look around the room. Sit down. Trade shows. Okay. Shout out some more so I don't have to think. What are a couple other ones? Obviously, everybody didn't stand up. What else? What? Direct sales. Well, it's Salesforce. What else? It's direct sales. Okay, stand up. It's direct sales. Okay. Sit down. What else? Yell something else. Social media. Well, that's okay. Social, not digital. Stand up. Okay, sit down. You guys also here. Yes, I see the hands raised. Thank you. So, think about this. I already did this. Okay. So, do you understand that if one company gets all its business from one source only, you ready for this profound realization, this shocking realization, this, oh my God, I'm embarrassed realization? What would happen if you added multiple revenue sources to what you did now? I call it the Power Parthenon because it reminds me of the Parthenon in Greece. And it has all these support pillars driving revenue. If you limit revenue sourcing to just one approach, what could go wrong? Basically, if you're a salesperson that's driving places and calling, and there's a COVID, you can't do it. If you are dependent on Facebook and they change the algorithm, you're sort of screwed. I can go on and on. You get it. So here is a graphic that reminds me of most businesses. The top, I call it the diving board theory. Pardon my voice. I'm sounding like Tony now, and I'm not trying to emulate him. Pardon me. But the revenue is the top. The bottom is the support beam. That's the one source. I call it a diving board because a diving board is affirmatively a propellant upward temporarily as you start plummeting back to Earth. If anything goes wrong, you're screwed. So what I do with all my clients, and what you should do with yourself if you want to be your own client, is start building more support pillars that generate revenue. And I'm going to give you the 10-10-10 analogy in a minute. Look at the visual if you had eight. I try to get eight or 10 sources. And if the left is the main driver, I just arbitrarily put stuff in here, digital, direct sales, referral systems, joint ventures, SEO, things like that. But if the left is 100% and each of the right are 10-15% more, do you see that's another version of 10-10-10-10? Yes. And sometimes you hit really powerful. And many times when you add more, you access market segments you're not getting normally, or you access somebody that isn't moving by the first one. Does this make sense? Yes. Is this like super obvious when you see it? Are you going, oh my God? You can say it out loud, oh my God. That wasn't a very sincere, oh my God. One more time. All right, I like that. Okay, so you can also do sub-pillars. We have 125 referrals strategies. I have about 40 ways to use lead generating. I mean, you haven't begun to even scrape the outer periphery veneer of your opportunity. Do you understand that? You don't have to say yes. I don't need it. I don't need it. Listen, honestly, when I used to do seminars, at the end, people would want to stand up and clap and acknowledge. I said, the only acknowledgement I need, besides the larger ones working with me, and it's not really crass, is go home and do something. That's a better acknowledgement than that or standing up. I don't need it. I know my stuff works. It's worked all over the world. We got $50 or $100 billion. You need to know it. Okay, the Power Parthenon embellishes the strategy a winning general uses guiding the offense and the defense in war to win just victoriously. In business, you win and you decimate your competitor. It's called the force multiplier effect. Anybody ever been in the military? Okay, so you would know what this is. If we were fighting and what's your name? If Maureen was, well, I met you before, a long time ago in Amsterdam. Was it Amsterdam? Okay, doesn't matter. We met. Wasn't that kind of a thing. Is that your husband? Okay. Oh, wow. Don't tell your husband. Oh, you're real estate. Okay, here goes. Quickly. So in military, if you want to win against the enemy, you don't just do one thing. You deploy everything. You target their infrastructure. You knock out communications. You knock out the railroad, the airport, the harbor, the telecommunication, the internet. And then you use bombs, and you use missiles, and you use drone strikes, and you use blockades, and you use propaganda and tanks and infantry. Does that make sense? And you don't care which one is the winning salvo. You want to decimate. I mean, You don't want to be just nice. You want to ethically have every ethical advantage you can. Think of business like a T-square. This is everybody. You want to have more advantage in your favor on everything, but it has to be ethical. It's not hard. Your competitor doesn't understand any of this. I have not shared this with anybody. Swear to God, strike me dead. You're the only one. I created it for you. If you do anything with it. No, no, I need to clap. I'm just telling you facts. This is powerful. It's very powerful. Okay, so how many additional sources of revenue and market penetration that heretofore have not been accessible are you going to consider testing? You only need one. Remember Tony's five to thrive? So think about that graphic. Okay, my goal is just to get about 10% more for each one, but you oftentimes find winners. Now, occasionally, I'll accept neutral. Let me tell you why. I used to run very, very, very big ads in the in-flight. 16, 20, 25 pages, 24 pages. They all were four, divisible by four. I just wanted them to break even because I got all my business from the newsletters and the Tonys, but all the business people were flying, and they would see this unimaginable. It had testimonials. It had quotes from everybody. We had three pages of testimonials, but not just testimonials. You know, most people's testimonial will say R.S. Wisconsin. Ours would have the name of the person, the name of the business, the picture of the person. Oh, and by the way, it had a daytime phone number to call. And it was so mind-boggling, formidable, that people went, oh, my God. I used to give away one of my $500 programs. Oh, by the way, seminar, this is so cool. So when I started doing seminars, this is the coolest thing. This is 35 years ago. We would send out, it would be endorsed. So let's say that Maureen had a newsletter. It was going to endorse me. First thing we would do is send a letter to your people from you, and it would offer a one-day consult with me. Back then, it was 50 grand. Today, it's 120, but back then, it was 50 grand. And we would be tickled if we got one, because it would absorb the cost of the mark of the mailing. But people would, then we sent a week later a letter from Maureen that said so many people were incredulous that anybody could charge that much, but equally as credible and incredulous wondering what they did that they could charge that much. And they said, is there any way, Maureen, that we could get access to Jay affordably? And she called Jay, and Jay said, guess what? Sure. Get 500 people at five grand, I'll do 3 days. It's like 50 times three, 150 for five grand, 30 time ROI. And I'll even make sure that if they don't like it, they don't have to pay. And we would kill because we set up ethically the market. I have people that I would give a $500 program, they would market. I'd let them keep all the money because we found there was a correlation. Every time we sold 10 of them, we had at least one person spend 25 grand with us. Every time we got five people to spend 25 grand, one would spend 200 grand. But if you don't know the correlations, you don't know how to optimize it. We talked about podcast books. Books, okay, when you see this book, we don't care about making a penny. It's all about deal flow. Roland and I, separately and together, are looking for deals. I'm looking for big clients. I can get a base fee and a very large portion, not larger than they get, but most money on the performance. He's looking for deals he can buy or get an equity for consulting. Tony's got all these deals. I'm sure he gets equity for being Tony and advising them. We don't care about the book. We care that the book's a bestseller, but it's just a vehicle. Okay, this is important. When you create a Power Parthenon, it's 10 times 10 times 10 times 10. You're taking your profits beyond exponential. Pretty mind-blowing, isn't it? Okay, we're getting close. I got 8 minutes. Shit, I got about... can I do it? I got two more to do after this. Okay, the nine drivers of exponential profit. I'm going to go very easy in this because this is more in the line of what I've done with a lot of you that I now think I should have done this first because I think it will help you in a more granular and a more easier way. But these are the things you change a little, but they're longer plays and they produce a lot. So strategy. It's the difference between being tactical and super strategic. I'll tell a story real quickly. I don't know if I have time, but it's so profound. Two people I knew wanted to get in the simulated diamond business years ago. One was a great copywriter, but he was tactical. The other was a okay copywriter who was strategic. The great copywriter wrote an ad, full-page ad, for a $39 one-carat loose stone. He ran it in Los Angeles Times, full page. It cost him $7,000. It brought in about $25,000. After everything, he made about $8,000. Wasn't enough for him. He quit, sent the little loose stones out, went on his way. He was tactical, doing it really fast. I could take a longer. The other guy wasn't a very good copywriter. He wrote a full-page ad selling a $39 loose stone, but he was brilliant strategic. He didn't do $25,000. His was $7,000, only pulled about, I don't know, 20. He lost about $4,000. But the first man who was tactical threw this loose stone in a crappy little case with a little note and just sent it out. The strategic guy put his in a velvet jewel case. He put it in a simulated wood box in a protected bubble with two documents. One was a letter from him as the president. Funny name. He called it Van Plissenticity, a take on Van Cleef and Arpel and Tiffany's. And it's called the Van Pliss Diamond. And he wrote a letter that said, "We're so gratified that you had enough blind trust to buy the loose stone. Before you take it out, we have to warn you it's going to be over." I mean, he said it differently. "We're going to have to alert you. It's going to be more bedazzling, more alive, more fiery, more brilliant, more mesmerizing than you ever thought. However, it's going to seem smaller. And it's not because we cheated you. It's that in order to get that kind of brilliance, the density is more. So it's weight. It's got more weight per whatever." And he said, "When people see how brilliant it is, they almost all come back and ask if we've got larger stones. Big 5, 10, 15 carat stones they can take to their jeweler and get set in rings and necklaces and all kinds of things. And we would sell them, and then we'd see the jewelers charge them an arm and a leg. And we happen to be a manufactured jeweler, so we thought, well, why don't we do it for you?" So we have set gorgeous stones in fabulous 14, 18 carat settings, and we've priced it about half of what your jeweler would. And we want to let you consider buying it with the stone in it. We won't consider your purchase binding on your part till you first of all got it, had a bunch of people in your life tell you how amazing it is, take it to your best, most trusted jeweler and ask him what it would cost to replace it. If it isn't twice as much, send it back. And oh yes, because you've had blind faith, we'll give you twice credit for what you bought if you want to send it back to us. And by the way, we gave you an envelope to do it, and there's a catalog with everything in it." Friend one, who was tactical, made about $7,000 or $8,000 and quit. Friend two, a strategic, lost $3,000 and made $25 million in year one profit. Very different between being, no, I don't need the clap. But do you see, being strategic is so different than being tactical? Okay, marketing. You can change so many elements in your marketing. Your value, your sales, there's these 9 factors in your ad, your proof factors, your risk reversal, your price. Test all these. You can test the market you go to, the vehicle you use, the offer you make, the prospect buying, what you do with them when you get them, the sales training of your people, the media sources. McDonald's, when they go, "Oh, you want to supersize it? Do you know how much money that makes them? Oh, you want fries with that? Do you know how much money that makes them?" I've tested $15 over 19 many ways. Sometimes 15, it wins by 5 times. Sometimes 19. Oh, gosh, we're running quick. Business model. You change your business model, you change your results. Think about it. When somebody sells 12 records for a penny, do you think they're making money? Or do you think they've analyzed the lifetime value and know that a finite number of them are going to keep buying? They're going to make profit at a certain point. The $59 steak and hamburger package, the Wall Street Journal wine club for $39, you get 12 bottles, timeshare giving you a cheap vacation. By the way, I've looked up what everybody, I looked up a treatise on 50 people trying to explain business model. Nobody can. The key is it's got 2 components. Everybody agrees. It's how the enterprise creates value perception so people want it, and how the enterprise creates value collection, how to get people to pay for it. That's a simple concept. Capital. Geez, there's all these ways to use financial capital, relational capital, intellectual capital, human capital. I've got a list here, but I'm going to go through it later because it would take too long, and I'm going to try to race my 3 minutes. Okay, relational capital, how you use other people's access to the market, endorsers, knowledge transfer, co-branding, getting introduction, Modeling for Millions means there's people all over doing the same thing. If you can get a license on their advertising, their selling approaches, anything. This is so cool. We had it was a lumber mill that had a process for kiln drying that was four times cheaper. It's cost them four times less than anything else, and that's the key expense. The guy was making $2 million a year, but he could give the lumber away after a certain geography. It didn't make any sense. So he taught his method to every lumber mill outside, and he was making $10 million teaching it for $25,000 a year and $2 million doing it. We did the same thing with the car wash. They had a process for upgrading the $29 package, and it was making them $20,000 extra a month. But their functional, I think their perimeter they was drawing from was like about 5 miles. We got 1,000 car washes to pay $200 a piece to use it. They're making $200,000 letting other people use it and $20,000 themselves. Distribution channels, adding and replacing sources, forces where you generate business. I'm gonna go fast. A phone service built a huge market using MLN. My cellular client, I have a cellular client, was a former Platt. And he basically created every kind of relationship. He's in Target. He's was in eBay. He was doing a deal with every ethnic cell phone company. Botox, they start with dermatologists, then they go to med spas, then they go to ophthalmologists, then they go to dentists. Change your product or service. You understand, I'm not going to go through all this because it's fast. If you create another product, low-end or high-end, it gives you two advantages. It gives you two advantages. Low-end lets you have an entry level that makes it easier to start. Lower-end can be added to each sale and double your profit, not your revenue. High-end lets you extend the lifetime value and thus multiply dramatically how much you can invest to bring the first sale in or compensate as salespeople. It's pretty profound. Change your process, procedures. I can go through lots of that. Breakthroughs don't really come from inside. They come from outside. Quick example. I have something called funnel vision versus tunnel vision. By the way, best practices has a fallacy in it. Here's what it is. Best practices is only relevant if you're the first one to learn it. I mean, it gives you better, but if everybody in your industry learns it and they're doing it, is it best practices or is it standard operating procedure? Now you're marginalized again, but if you borrow methodologies, approaches from outside, guess what? You kill it. Fiber optics, which transformed telecommunications, didn't come from telecommunications, it came from aerospace, it was borrowed. FedEx borrowed what's called the hub and spoke check clearing process from Federal Reserve Bank, how checks are cleared so they don't bounce first thing in the morning, and they turned the whole industry. Rogaine came from pimples, supposed to say Viagra, came from heart. Baby buggy, the most successful baby buggy. They do $300 million. They borrow the collapsible wheels from airplanes. Ideology. This is Tony incarnate. Your beliefs drive your behaviors. Your behaviors drive the result. It's impossible unless you shift it. We have something called the Mindstein effect. It's how to be like Einstein, and you don't need really intellect as much as you need the other 10 attributes. It was his curiosity, his humor, his dogged commitment, his willingness to understand the problem before he tried to deeper than find. And it goes a bunch of things. Safe, conservative test. You can test so many things. You can lose more often than win, and you have an enormous payoff when you win. Being an exponential entrepreneur, making success a natural part of everything you do, every action you take, every decision you make. I know that seems axiomatic, but nobody does it. Nobody does it. They make failure, or they make sub-optimization, highest and best use theory. And also, when you're hiring people, there's a quote, hire the best and only cry once. Because the best superstars will be 5-10 times more valuable than somebody that's not. And the only time you'll cry is when you have to agree to pay them. It doesn't matter because they'll be a better profit center than anybody. Okay, getting more than you expect. How is this? How can you mess up, though? What's going to happen? And now we've got the sticking points. How do you get stuck? Want to know? I got 3 minutes to do it. Are you stuck losing out to competition? Well, you probably don't have a preemptive preemptive positioning. You probably aren't preeminent. You probably don't have better distribution channels. You probably don't have a way to start a relationship before everybody else. Are you stuck not selling enough? You probably don't have a system to keep advancing and enhancing business. Are you stuck with erratic business volume? If you're waiting and you're reactive and it's episodic, who do you have to blame? Go to the mirror and point. Are you stuck failing to strategize? I just made the point. You see the difference between being tactical, 2D thinker, or three? It's pretty profound. Are you stuck with your cost eating it up? You know, you can convert. There's a lot of experts here. But if somebody came to you and said, I'll pay you five times your fee based on your service producing a result, and you knew they would implement, would you do it? Or if you got pegged into performance, most of you that don't use a lot of experts, they're experts like me that charge a lot. There's a lot of very competent experts that aren't fully utilized and they have time. If you can give them a correlation that pays them for results or overpays them for results, you can get every expert you want to work for you on a performance basis. Are you stuck doing what's not working and you don't know it? Say yes. Say yes louder.
Yes.
You think maybe today you feel how to get unstuck because you see alternatives that are a lot more pragmatic, profitable, easy, safe, and doable? Yes.
Yes,
yes virtual people. Gary Katz, yes. Okay. Are you stuck being marginalized by the market? Yeah, you are because you're not preeminent. Yeah, you are because you're not out-thinking, out-marketing, out-contributing, out-valuing. Come on, man. Okay, this is the last one. We're in the home stretch, but I only have 2 minutes. Can you do it? Okay, maybe you want to give me five more because I'm almost done, guys. Five more, and I'm for not for me, for them. Give me seven. I promise I'll bring it home. They did it. Thanks. Okay. Step seven. This is, what do I call it? This is like sublime. This is economic sublime. This is so cool. So it incorporates leverage. If I told you that you could freely have access to millions, tens of millions, hundreds of millions, billions of dollars of other people's asset, investment, goodwill, would you, and it cost you nothing, would you be happy to do that? Okay, you want me to do it right now? Okay. So joint venture, power partnering, joint venturing, strategic alliances, co-branding, recommended provider, endorsement. Basically, it gives you an unlimited amount of upside. So you can leverage off of all the salespeople, all the things people done to build a brand, all the buyers, all the technology people have. All the credibility, all the loyalty. Okay, let me go fast. Quick example. Great story. Man goes to one of the Rothschilds years ago and wants to borrow $100,000. Rothschild says, I won't give you $100,000, but I'll do something far better. I will walk arm in arm with you up and down the stock exchange twice, and when we're done, everybody there will loan you all the money you want. That's the essence. I see out, we use the goodwill of the radio and TV. My seminars, I use Tony newsletters. Tony used Fran Darkin. DHL used the radio stations. Entrepreneur Magazine did exchanges with people for their advertising to get them to promote to their database. Carnival Cruise, great story. Carnival Cruise, true story, was started by a guy that had no money. He had one used boat. He couldn't even afford to paint on one side. True story, because one of my friends worked there. They would bring it in on the painted side. It would go out every week 50% filled. That means 50% empty. Let's take a hypothetical. If it's 800 rooms, 400 empty, $1,000 a room per week, that's 400 grand down the drain, literally. My friend got the idea of going to radio stations, television stations, and trading them this unused cabin for advertising, but he got a better one. He said, we need the advertising now. You can use your credits anytime for 2 years. So he's using it now, getting cash paying. They're not using it for 2 years. It was dollar denominated, meaning the time value of money is less. When they exercised it, almost everyone would pay to bring other people. He charged a surcharge of $100 that covered literally all the food and the maids. And they went that was how they started. This is a great one. So there was a Porsche enthusiast years ago. He loved Porsche automobiles, but he couldn't afford one. He found that a smaller Porsche dealer in his state was for sale. He didn't have any money, but he wanted to find out. This was very quick. He just wanted to see the offering document. He looked at it, and he was reading every little codicil and everything. He found something that really rocked his boat, and he used that to do something profound. He found that a Porsche dealer, any dealer back then, you could let people drive a car for 3 months as a demo, and as long as it only had 3,000 miles on it then, they could sell it as new. He ran an ad in all the financial publications, and it said, drive a brand new Porsche every year for life for a one-time investment of 75 grand. He got 200 people to do it. They got to use a demo for a short period. He ended up with the down payment, which was $1 million. He had excess operating cash. He had all these people, which many of them bought it. They were all his greatest advocates. Oh, by the way, he didn't give one iota of equity away. He didn't have one iota of repayment. It was pretty cool. A last one I'll do. I got all these here, but I'll do Colonial Penn. It's pretty cool. So Colonial Penn was started as literally a group insurance company, and they weren't doing well. They were having trouble getting their clients. One of the directors after years said, look, if we can't get a client, let's start our own. So they created something called the AARP, the American Association of Retired People, just so they'd have a client. They did billions of dollars. Pretty cool, huh? I'll get more stories. Okay. Remember in April when Roland and I were here? Yes, those of you who are here. Well, I've got a partnership with Roland. I got a partnership with the dental guy. I got a partnership in Japan where we have 4,000 people on a virtual mastermind. I don't have one penny invested. I have a partnership. I had one in Spain. I have got one with Anthony Scaramucci on another book. I've got one in Italy where a guy does all the work. I got one in Australia. I've got one in France. Or I had one. How many do you have? This is important. 2,000 of the top corporations now get 20% of their revenue and 40% of their profit from partnerships. Microsoft, 95% of one division comes from partners. Shopify, partner ecosystem generated $6.9 billion in revenue. Accenture acquired whatever ZoomWorks just for their partner relations. SAP acquired whatever Qualtrics for $8 billion, and it went public for 21. Channel partners in Japan, 40% of Zoom. High growth brands are three times more likely to have marketing partnerships. The largest affiliate network in the United States, 250,000 partners. 57% of organizations use partnerships to acquire new customers. I can go on. If they do it, do you think maybe you could do it in some scale? Maybe. Cost you nothing, no risk. It's all upside. Okay, 9 benefits of power partnering. You can use it to achieve advantages of scale, scope, speed. You can increase market penetration. I can go deep on all these. I have 43 variants of it. You can enhance your competitiveness in local national markets. You can enhance product development. You can develop new business opportunities galore, just as up to your imagination. You can create new businesses at will. You can get control of other people's products and services and put it through your distribution or put your products through theirs. You can use it to do joint ventures, to reduce costs, increase profits. Anything you couldn't afford. I got one more story, and then I'm going to get to the lessons. And I got a minute and a half, but maybe they'll let me do the lessons. I'm almost there, guys. I'm going to go through it. Okay, true story. Years ago, I used to do conferences and seminars in China. The first one I did, very expensive, a young man comes to the mic at the end and asks a question. He says, what do you do if the bank won't lend you money to grow? I said, tell me more. He said, I'm a small local motorcycle manufacturer. Only in China, where there's 100 million population in a city, are you a small local motorcycle manufacturer. I said, well, what would you do with the money? If I could get the money, I'd go all over Asia. I'd find I'd create a factory. I'd get offices in all the countries. I'd get salespeople, dealers. I said, okay, what's the problem? And he got mad. He goes, a lot of people go, and I'll tell you one more if I have time at the end. And he goes, I told you they won't give me money to grow. I said, you don't need money. You have to realize your problem. This is very important. And Delby, write this on the underneath side of your foot. Your problem is always going to be the solution to somebody else's bigger problem or opportunity. They just don't know it. I said, go all over Asia. Go on a road trip. See if you can find somebody in a complementary, not a competitive world that has a huge factory underutilized, offices in a bunch of countries, salespeople, dealers, and make a deal with them. Took me a minute. 15 months later, swear to God, I came back. This young man comes to the mic. He looks like the Cheshire Cat. He goes, I did what you said, Jay, and I answered questions all day long. I didn't even remember. He told me what I told him. I said, what'd you do? I went all over Asia. When I got to Kuala Lumpur in Malaysia, I found Asia's largest lawnmower manufacturer. They had a huge factory. They weren't using second shift at all. We made a deal. They provided the people. They had the equipment. I just had to bring the tools and dies. And if you don't know what those are the metal that forms parts that are assembled into the product. They had offices in every country, 10. I went and I trained the salespeople. They had thousands of dealers. He said, in our first year together, for almost no real investment, we both made $15 million. So you guys can do the same thing on some scale. Okay, a lot to process in 2 hours. Now I'm going to give you takeaways. You ready? You can write these down if you want. You can take pictures if you want. You can take pictures. You're the official picture taker now, okay? Thank you. All right. First, never again do something that is merely incremental or that does not advance or enhance a far more profitable ongoing goal. Promise?
Yes.
Two, always optimize. Always, always. There's always been multiple ways to better work on the geometry of your business, but you can't know it if you don't. By the way, optimization is impossible if you don't commit to try to learn the alternatives, the higher performing possibilities that are out there. You're living in this, what I call basically this very insular world. It's not reality, it's your reality. Always know what's the best, the easiest, the fastest, the safest, highest performing way to do something, be something, reach somebody, communicate, market, focus. Just choose one technique available from each of the seven steps. You're going to get the PowerPoint too, but take these pictures. The simplest, the easiest, not the hardest. You want wins. Let success results motivate and propel you to go higher and higher. Remember, it all supports 10, 10, 10. Four, you have time. Don't stress. It's taking you all this time to get to where you are. These are very powerful, very fast, but don't stress. There's no shame in taking a while to add additional, but once they start working, reinvest. If you can't do it all, don't go, well, I got to do a few. If I make you today $10,000 extra a month because you do one thing, do you think maybe if you put five of it into a person to do five more things, maybe it'll leverage up instead of having a new car or a vacation? Okay. I don't know what that, oh, okay. I said it, where's number five? Uh-oh, do we lose number five? Uh-oh. Oh, crawl before you walk. Think about something. Anybody here have children? Do you remember when your children were little, like just learning to walk or talk or poop or eat, or a little older when they're trying to ride a bike? Were they good the first time they tried? Did they get up and go, I'm gonna do the Gettysburg Address at age one? Did they basically run a marathon at age one? Did they reach the toilet, jump up and land, you know what, right in the toilet? Did they put the spoon in their mouth or their eye? Did they get on the bike and just zoom and do a race? No, they fell. They were terrible. When you start something, give yourself permission. It won't be perfect unless you're extraordinarily lucky or gifted, and just keep trying. That's why you try the easiest, safest, and then you course correct and you adjust, and you'll do fabulous. Okay, everything I've shared is totally success probable. Give yourself permission to embrace, apply, enjoy the fruits of far greater business prosperity and success by shifting what you were doing yesterday to what I'm trying to basically spoon feed you to start doing tomorrow. These magnificent seven concepts will, they not can, they will absolutely deliver when you apply them. So remember, a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a step. You got to commit to do the step. There's a quote from a famous advertising guy, when you reach for the moon and the stars, one thing is certain, you won't end up with a handful of mud. Each of these multiplies when you combine and add them. And your goal in business is to think, you're paid to think, by your market, by your business, by your team, but to not think the same. You're paid to outthink everyone else, to outmarket everyone else, to outstrategize everyone else, to outposition, outvalue. And if you do that, you outperform and out-earn, period. Okay, back at the goal in business, always should be to gain absolute ethical advantage by making a bigger difference, by adding more value, by caring far more about the people you serve, your clients, team, and vendors. Jay Abraham, ta-da, I'm done.